Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Safari Live. It's a pre-show show. So myself and Brian are out, and Brian, you want to say hello? Say hello to everyone.
Hello, everyone. Yes, back from leave. Yes.
Brian's back from leave.
He came back yesterday, but
he's officially back because he's now been spotted on camera. So he's officially back. All right, Brian, I've got to concentrate here a little bit. I've got to try and look for some tracks. It's a bit early to concentrate this hard, but we'll try our best. Hope you're all having a wonderful evening or morning or day, wherever you are in the world. All our viewers across the land, across the world rather, not across the land. It's still too early. Let me just speak to James. Sorry, hold on a second, Brian. Just wait, Brian. Morning, James. No updates just yet. Just you and I out so far. James is on the other vehicle this morning. It's just here. So, trying to get updates, listening to what people have seen or have heard during the course of the evening. Sorry, I'm now concentrating. Jerry, please say that again. So Jerry and Rebecca in FC this morning again. Right, and Katie, you said you hope to see some of the two other Birmingham males. We'll try our best, not sure if they are around. I didn't get a good look at them the other day. I only saw the one. I think it was Mfumo with that lioness the other day, and then there were the two others around, but I didn't get a good look at them, so I'm not sure who they were. They were kind of resting in the shade and hiding from us. James is on search for leopards this morning. I am on search for lions, and elephants. I want to see more elephants. I love elephants, as you all know. But we haven't seen too many for the last few weeks. The last 2-3 weeks have been a bit quiet with elephant. They have dispersed, and I think it's because of all the rain we've had. There's food everywhere now, and speaking of rain, look at those clouds. It appears to be ominous.
Ominous.
Word of the day, ominous.
Word of the day?
Well, I think we'll think
word
of
some. Morning.
Word of the morning, okay. You don't think it's worthy of word of the day? Ominous. There appears to be the hint of precipitation in the air. How's that? No, you see, now I'm starting to sound a little bit like James. Oh, no. No, that's not good. I don't want to sound like James. James sounds like James. I sound like me. We need to think of a little song at some point to sing, I think. Yeah, for pre-show show.
Yeah.
Yeah, not show, because that's official.
Maybe both.
I'm going to say goodbye now. I'm going to be very, very quiet. And we'll see you all shortly.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, everybody. That is a slightly macabre scene. My name is James Hendry, and this is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
Now, it's wonderful to have you here. Now, the reason I made that a rather amusing joke for this early in the morning was, of course, that Safari Live. Live means alive, and, well, we don't want a show called Safari Dead, do we now, genre? No. Now, my name is James Hendry. As I said, genre is on camera. On the other vehicle, Byron is driving around with Brian, and that is a deeply confusing situation for all of us to have to deal with at this time of the morning. Also going to be out on foot, Jamie Patterson, the elegant antelope. She'll be walking around with, it must be Vium. That will be an interesting, no?
Eggsy.
Good grief, now we are in for a treat this morning. Now, that's excellent. Okay, so that's the team out this morning. And please do talk to us for the course of the morning. Hashtags for our live questions at wildearth.tv. And I'll tell you a little bit about this hapless impala that is in the tree there. That is a young impala lamb, of course, born probably not a week ago, and been hauled into the tree by the great queen herself. Johan from Hunter's Moon found her yesterday evening, from Jacana in Biffle's Hook, found her yesterday evening just having killed that thing, probably around 8 o'clock apparently. Now, she's not there now, clearly, and so she's therefore probably gone to fetch the cubs. We don't know exactly where the cubs are. We don't know how long it's going to take her to come back here. I'm pretty sure she will come back here. But we'll sit here for a little while and see if we can't hear some alarm calling of birds or perhaps other impala as she reapproaches the kill to eat. But in the meantime, we'll probably drive around, see what else we can see, and return here periodically to see when and if she comes back. I'm 90% sure she will come back, and I'll just give you an idea of how close we are to camp. Can you see any piece of camp there, Jandri? Just at the end of this clearing. We're on quarantine clearings, of course, which is the main clearing just outside the camp. Jerry is pretty much down behind that termite mound in the final control with Rebecca. So this really is right close to camp, and it's so great, of course, that all of this stuff happens just outside our very front door. Now let's head across to Byron and find out from Byron and Brian what they're going to be doing this morning.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this morning is Brian. And the thumb is the thumb. The thumb is very, very official this morning. Morning, thumb. So Brian and Byron on game drive this morning. It's very confusing for the ladies in the FC, which is wonderful. We think it's quite funny. Now, myself and Brian are heading out looking for any lions or signs of lions, anything really. We're just currently checking the roads for tracks. Exciting that James has found an impala in a tree, and it's potentially Karula has made a kill in that area. That would be wonderful if she went to go and fetch the cubs. And I must be honest, it's a pity it's a lamb. And I say that purely because it's not quite a lot of food. It would be better if she got something a little bit more substantial. And that's often a little snack. But this time of year is great for impala lambs, for these predators, especially leopards. So she could potentially hunt a lot more of them. I'm having a look. I'm on the boundary, the southern boundary, or our southern boundary for now. And just having a look to see if we've got any tracks around here. It seems to be a little bit quiet this morning. And we saw those clouds. Brian was predicting rain. I'm not so sure. I don't know. I'm trying to stay positive. So I did not bring a rain jacket. But I might be tempting fate then. Who knows? It's a lovely morning though, nice cool morning. I prefer these cool mornings to those hot muggy mornings that we can get in summer. This is very pleasant to drive around in, and I'm hoping that we get quite a bit of animal activity today, this morning especially. We had had such an incredible walk yesterday. I really enjoyed it. And we got to see a boomslang, a female boomslang. Those of you who missed it, we got to see a female boomslang in a tree. She shot out very close to us. We startled her. She went into a tree, and the boomslang is also known as the tree snake. Very, very good climber. And then two white-faced owls sitting in the same tree. They are also known as the white-faced Scops owl. Let me just show you a picture, perhaps, so you can have a look. Those of you who didn't see it yesterday, they're beautiful, beautiful birds. And they do this, they've got this incredible behavior that they do. And I'll explain to you now when I show you the picture. But the adults, there we go, southern white-faced owl, white-faced Scops owl. And that is it over there. That is the picture of it as it would be in the book. There we go. So beautiful, beautiful bird. I'm just going to show you some pictures. And that's what we saw. And these two beautiful owls were sitting in the tree, and we could just see them. Fortunately, because they are nocturnal, they did not fly away. So we sat watching them for ages while the snake was right at the top of the tree. It was not hunting these birds. They're a little bit too big for them. For that little boomslang. But I'm trying to think if they've got a picture. They don't. But this owl does this incredible, and it doesn't, you can kind of get an idea of it there. See those beautiful tufts of feathers on the head? Looked almost like ears. Sorry, some bugs flying around. And they do this incredible little, it's not quite a display, but it's behavior that they do. And what it is they kind of suck their bodies up. It's true, they make themselves really, really thin, and they try to blend in to the trees, into the branches, to camouflage themselves. So they'll hide there, and they go kind of like that. But they do, they like suck themselves up, and they make themselves really thin, and they hide in the branches. And one of them was doing it yesterday. It was incredible to see. And then when they're normal, they kind of puff themselves out again, which is interesting. But it was very, very fascinating to see. It was the first time I've seen it, and it was nice to see those owls and the snake. I love snakes, I really do. So it was great to be able to watch one and chat about it. I was wondering if we were going to see the sunrise this morning. I thought it was going to be a bit cloudy, but it appears as if though James has found a nice clear view of the sunrise.
Now we have to sit very still, everybody, because Jandre is shooting this. That means he's recording it. Is it not magnificent? That's the sun about to peep up over the clouds, in case you thought perhaps we had found a volcano to film. So I'm speaking with very even tone and not moving my body while I breathe. How am I doing, Jandre? Jandre says I'm doing okay. Isn't that gorgeous? Apocalyptic almost. So what we've done, everyone, is leave where the kill is, because there comes the sun, simply because we know that the kill is there, obviously, and so we'll go back there periodically during the course of the morning and see what there is there. And in the meantime, we'll hopefully get some kind of view of Karula. Perhaps on her way to the kill. Isn't that lovely? I think that's too gorgeous for words. Don't you, Gendry? Gendry's not allowed to speak, everyone. Gendry, say when we can go. You could sit here all day, could you? I'm just not sure that we should do quite that. Yes, we can wait for it to rise. Sorry. Oh, that is just too wonderful. I'm not sure if you're getting quite the same picture. So I'm looking at my monitor, everyone, and I'm looking obviously also at the sun coming up, but the colours, all sides of it, which we'll never be able to quite capture on a camera, are just too special. Gosh, that's gorgeous. And that, everyone, is Africa. That is why, of course, we live here. Because every single day, some form of natural wonder assails our eyes. Wow. Very special indeed. All right, Gendry, shall we press on? Or are you happy there? In fact, that is too gorgeous. Let's keep watching. You'll notice Gendry is being very silent, and that means that he doesn't agree with me. When he doesn't say anything, he means no.
No, I'm recording it because it is gorgeous.
It is very gorgeous. Can you hear the birds, everybody? We've got ring-necked doves going prop-prop, the gentle call of the ghost bird or grey-headed bushrike. A white-bellied sunbird. That's the worst white-bellied sunbird I've ever heard. There, you've just heard it there. Red-billed buffalo weavers. Grey go-away birds, those are birds definitely we must be listening out for this morning, because of course if they see Karula they will say quack, quack. In fact, they're starting to call from the direction that I think perhaps Karula is going to come, so we'll start moving gently down towards that area. Johan from Jokana is still sitting at the tree where the kill is, so if she does arrive he will no doubt let us know. Gosh, that's wonderful, isn't it? Lucy, that's quite a good question from you about how Karula knows where to find the kill once she goes off. Basically, you're asking about animal navigation. How does she know how to find the kill again when she returns? And the answer, Lucy, is that we're not entirely sure. For the big cats, though, I suspect it's got a lot to do with visual cues. I think they spend a huge amount of time walking around the same areas, and I think they know intimately every nook and cranny within their territories. So I think it's visual cues. She just recognizes the landscape. I'm sure there's an element of smell involved, but in the same way, I think it's probably familiar parts of her territory that smell the same. So there will be an element of smell. I think it's largely visual, probably, though, for Karula. And I've been reading quite a lot about smell of late and how it functions. And it really is just a fascinating, fascinating subject. I've always been quite interested in it because I have a sensitive nose. And the ability of animals to smell things and find things through smell really is beyond our imagining. Because our noses are so weak relatively, it's almost impossible for us to understand what it is like to have a strong sense of smell. So for example, as I said yesterday, oops, hang on, my microphone's just leapt off my face. What happens is, with something like a bloodhound, like I said yesterday, 40 times the ability to smell what we can. And I think you'll find a hyena is probably even better than them, quite a lot better than that. Now, I mean, just to put that in perspective, a shark can smell a drop of blood in the water from a distance of well over a mile, which I think is quite impressive. But out here, apparently something like a... what was the example they used? I think it was a bear can smell a carcass or something like that at probably up to 20 kilometers. That's 12 miles. Now, if I hadn't read that in a reputable book, you know, you read that sort of thing in these field guides that you buy, which are, you know, they're often fairly anecdotal. I mean, that is, it's quite astonishing that an animal's, what they call the nasal epithelium, that's a part of the of your nose that picks up the molecules of scent, but that they can pick up such tiny fractional amounts of scent on the air. So it's probably picking up one or two molecules into the nasal epithelium and interpreting it, and interpreting where, of course, it's coming from, which I just think is absolutely astounding. Right, let's continue. The sun, the last ray of that sunshine has disappeared, and let's find if we can't see the great queen coming towards us now. Those birds have stopped going quack, so it's possible that she's come through the bush, left where the birds are, and is now marching across the clearing. Let's go and find out. It's also possible that they were shouting at each other and not her at all. Now, I'm in Rusty this morning, which of course has been modified so that Brent Leo Smith's very vast frame gets to stick out of the car. So you can see that there is no door. It's actually quite nice. That's how we used to take game drive in the good old days, you know. We never had a door. Makes us feel very brave and manly, except when there's a black mamba coming towards us. Then it makes us feel very scared. There are a whole lot of impala all around this clearing, and they are obviously lurking about the place, blissfully ignorant that one of their number is hanging in a tree not too far away. But it also means, of course, that Karula is probably not lurking around here. So that was a baby impala, obviously, and they, of course, 50% of them probably will not see their first birthdays. They are the best thing to eat at the moment for everything out here, sort of a little bit of impala veal, if you like, and much easier to kill than the adults. And so while the males take a... Oh, hang on, there we go. What are they looking at? It could be the fight. Thank you, Jean-André. Well, they're just looking at us, but the ones to the left, that one's, of course, relieving itself. They were looking up towards the top of the clearings, but they definitely haven't seen a leopard. They would alarm call. Hmm. Michael, you can get yourself into a great deal of trouble with our viewers if you dare to cast aspersions on Karula's fitness as a mother. You say, shouldn't she have gone for something larger, given that she has two young mouths to feed? No. You say she knows... You also qualify that, of course, by saying that you know leopards are opportunists. Absolutely, this isn't going to last them a long time, but she'll just kill another one, probably fairly soon. You're absolutely correct. They're completely opportunistic, and that's exactly what she's done. She's taken the opportunity to get an easy meal, and so she'll just get lots more easy meals. I mean, there's almost no injury risk for her to have a go at an impala lamb, whereas there always is if she's going to take an adult male, and she does take adult males, especially when they're overwhelmed by desire for the female. females are not paying attention to what's going on, then absolutely what happens is that she will take the males, and they are definitely more of a meal for her and for her cubs, but there's a lot more danger associated with killing a big male impala, whereas the little ones, of course, they don't really fight back when they're only a week old. Just, they're impala all over this place. Now, I don't know where she's come from or where she went yesterday evening, but we'll do a little bit more investigating around here and keep you posted. There is one impala female looking, but she's not, she's very dangerous there with her. I think that thing's born more recently than some of the others. Of course, she's just a little bit separated from the rest of the herd. I saw one other to the left. But they do spend a little bit of time away from... You see how wobbly it still is? Sweet. Crested barbet in the background. All right, we're going to hand you over to Byron, get an update from him. I know he's been off the vehicle. Perhaps he found some lion tracks. In the meantime, we'll keep our search for the queen.
So, James, I did jump off the vehicle for a brief second, but it appears, and it wasn't very clear, the substrate, the soil that I was looking on, was very difficult to see what it was exactly, but I think it's possibly leopard tracks, and I think it was tracks of Karula with the two young cubs crossing the Triple M boundary, heading towards Balanites. So I'm not sure. The one track did look very, very big, but I think it might have been an old lion track, actually. So I'm just having a good look here. I don't want to find the leopards before James does. He's been waiting very patiently for them. Just having a look. I thought I saw something. But no sign of lion tracks just yet. And have a look, just checking these areas very, very carefully. It's quite difficult. I do find it difficult to drive and track at the same time. I do think we miss a lot of tracks, to be honest, because sometimes you've got to scan, look for animals, as well as try and track. And if an animal's just crossed the road, for example, in front of you, it's very difficult to see the track and you probably miss it. But you see, there's quite a few impala around here, and they seem pretty relaxed. Not to say that there's not a predator in the area, but brakes are making a little noise. And look at all those little impala lambs running around. And just scuttled off into the thicket. There are quite a few around at the moment. It's amazing how quickly they all start popping up. Or popping out, rather, should I say. This is a very nice herd. This is quite a large herd of impala. With all these little lambs. And as I said, it becomes easy this time of year for leopards, and I've seen it many times where leopards do prefer hunting these little lambs. It becomes a little bit easier for them, but that's one of the reasons why impala have this breeding season and this birthing strategy, so that when there are so many lambs, if a few are killed, hunted and fed on, there are still a number of them which survive, and that's why the impala do so well, and that's why they're the most abundant antelope in this whole area. Anna-Marie, you asked, would jackals ever prey upon the impala lambs? Yes, Anna-Marie, they would. And to be honest, in this area, though, we mainly have these side-striped jackal. Side-striped jackal aren't as, what's the best way to describe them? They aren't as carnivorous as the black-backed jackal. These side-striped jackal may also feed on insects and fruit, but they will obviously scavenge off carcasses and that. I've never seen a side-striped jackal hunting any prey, though, something as large as an impala. However, I've seen black-backed jackal that have hunted antelope the size of a small impala and bigger. So the size of an impala lamb and even larger in some parts of the country. Let me see if I can get a picture of it for you. Some parts of the country we have an antelope known as the springbuck. Now, we do not have them in this greater Kruger area where we are in, or in the Sabi Sands. They occur generally in semi-arid and dry areas. And if you have a look, this is the size of a springbuck. Oh, that's a springbuck, which is generally just a bit smaller than an impala. Not by much, though, but they are smaller than impala. But I've seen black-backed jackal hunting these. So they are hunters if they need to be, even though they scavenge most of the time. But if they come across potential food, and if they work together, sometimes you get little packs of jackal moving together. You might see them hunting smaller antelope like this. So they would definitely go for an impala lamb, without a doubt. And hyena will also run and kill impala lambs, even impala, grown impala, full grown impala. Twinkle Glitter, you'd like to know if those young impala lambs would alarm call. I've never ever seen or heard impala lambs alarm call. It's only ever the adults. So, I'm leaning towards saying no, not at all. But as I always say, you know, it's very difficult to give an exact answer in nature because things do change. But at that age, those impala lambs, I don't think they call. Even yearlings, I've never seen a yearling standing calling. It's usually the adults. So I'm not sure if it's a case of they can't, or a case of they perhaps not experienced enough to know when to alarm call and they listen to the adults. I'm not sure. But impala lambs, I don't think alarm call at all. I've never heard them, and I've seen them being hunted a few times. Just having a look. It's nice to get to these junctions in a road and just have a look, because often what happens, you have leopards using these areas and roads, not just leopards but other predators too, and they use them as it's a large pathway at the end of the day for them. It's easier to move around in and to get from one area to the next. So it's nice to have a look at those junctions when you do get to them. Just make sure you can see if anything's moved around. Cindy, that's a very interesting and very difficult question to answer. You wanted to know what percentage of little lambs would make it to adulthood. I don't know. And the reason I say I don't know is because it depends on the area they're in, it depends on the amount of predators around. So there are a lot of different factors that have to be taken into account. To be honest, I would say somewhere between 40% and 60%, I would guess, on an average. But again, please don't quote me on that, because it's very difficult to gauge, and there's so many factors which need to be taken into account. have founded James Hendry. Morning, James.
Oh, hello.
Hello, James. Hello, Jandre.
Lovely to see you.
Hello, James.
You see that how I am sitting in this vehicle.
It's lovely without a door, I think.
It's lovely without a door, especially with legs like mine. Wouldn't you say, Brian?
Yes.
Yes.
So shapely.
So shapely for pretzels.
Mm. Toothpicks, some would say.
Yes. The legs of a plover.
The legs of a racing pigeon.
Of a racing pigeon. Yes. You think you have tracks coming this way?
To be honest, Triple M, not far from Impala Plains, just south of that little innit, crossing in.
This way.
This way, heading this way. And it did look like it was her.
With cups.
With the two little ones, yeah. But there was another track around there which was confusing. I think it's an old lioness track. But further in, it was very difficult to gauge.
All right, well, we'll go down Rebecca's and then back up the tree.
I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to head up towards Sandy Patch, then I'm going to try check around that area.
Okay.
All right. Good.
I would like you to please climb onto the vehicle here.
Oh, okay. All right, well then, jump on that vehicle, and then we'll see you all a little bit later. Bye.
Hello everybody, back on my car. Very nice to have you back here with us. Byron is heading obviously towards hopefully some lions. That was very amusing, wasn't it, Jandre? You see how we did the virtual game drive thing there? Wasn't that amazing? Yes. Well done, Jerry. Good opportunity there. Right. We are now going to go down Rebecca's Road, obviously, because I told you we were going to do that. Byron is talking, of course, of an area just over there where he saw the tracks heading back this way. Brent is now out on drive as well, so he's going to be looking around. We've got a few people here from National Geographic, and so Brenty is driving them around this morning, and so he too will be hot on the search. I've always thought it's kind of a safari holiday like they're on is hang on one sec, I just want to check something. No. It's quite a physical trial, you know. You spend all this money, you jet lag yourself to pieces getting out here, and then some guy tells you that when you go to bed on your first night that he's going to wake you up in about 4 hours' time, and then you're going to go out on a safari. It's the only holiday I know of where you are required to get up far earlier than you would normally, especially after an exceptional amount of jet lag. So something to bear in mind when you come on drive, but then you are of course deeply excited by the time the morning rolls around and the chances of going to look for something interesting have arisen. I've nearly fallen out of this car twice now because I keep leaning on the door that isn't there. Jandre, you will rescue me, won't you, if I fall out of the car? I've spotted an animal. It's deeply exciting. See it there, Jandre. It's a grey duiker. That grey duiker seemed to be climbing a mountain. There it is. There it is. A male grey duiker, very relieved that the Impala lambing season has arrived, because it means that he and his kin less likely to be devoured by leopards. They take a bit of a beating from leopards. Really the ideal leopard sort of food. I'll just keep an eye out on the ground for leopard tracks. Byron was slightly unsure there, and that's because the substrate that we're driving on now, the ground, is hard. It's got a sort of rainy crust on it, and if you're light like leopards are, well, they don't leave very obvious signs. Jandre, we might have to stop here for another scenic shot. What do you think? Oh, this is lovely. us just contemplate life quietly here. Isn't that not gorgeous? It's too gorgeous. I think Brent is looking for me on the radio, so I'm just going to call him. Ah, yes. He's talking about lions. He's got tracks of a pride. Just listening quietly. Yeah, the tracks of a pride of lions somewhere around here. He thinks crossing back into the reserve from the south. That's Brent. There's too many bees, aren't there? Brent, Byron, Brian. But that's what is going on there. So Brent is going to follow up on the lions, and we'll go and see if the Queen hasn't perhaps arrived. Right, on we go. Why is the car not starting? There we are. We're okay. Don't worry, everyone. Now, we have to get used to, of course, again, the sort of summer vegetation, very thick vegetation, and the ability of the animals to hide. And so from having these open areas and lots of animals who've been concentrating around the last sort of remaining food sources, we've now got much thicker bush and many, many, many more small things to show. Small animals, flowers, that sort of thing, and of course black-bellied bustards. They are hilarious looking birds, I think. They're the most incongruous sort of size. And when they fly, I'm just going to go back a little bit. When they fly, it is just the most bizarre thing because they look so unwieldy in the air. And I've seen one actually escape. I've seen one escape from an African hawk eagle before. So while they look ridiculous, they're actually very competent flyers. Come on, give us your call. Now, many of you would have seen that many times, of course. It never fails to amuse me. And what you should do next time you're on Byron's car, again, I had to stop because I didn't know whether I was going to say Brian or Byron. When you're on Byron's car, ask Brian to do that call, because he really is very good, very good at it. And apparently Geraldine says Herbie's even better at it. Now watch when it moves. See how the head stays still, and it kind of, the body catches up with the head. So it moves the head forward, then the head stops moving and the rest of the body catches up with it. Move slightly forward. You can still see it there, Jandri. Should be there. Rish. There it is. Unless it's running. But when it walks. Oh, it's found something delicious to eat. Mmm. I wonder if that doesn't have a function to do with, or have some kind of, I've lost my words now. So I think it probably tries to keep its head as still as possible. Well, it's not calling. In order that its eyes can fix on something, and it can accurately judge the distance. So once it's moved its head and judged the distance, it keeps its head as still as possible. Because they've got very, very fine coordination. You've got to be extremely coordinated and well-aimed in order to pick up the tiny little delicate fast-moving insects that that thing's picking up with its beak. And I'm sure that's why the movements of the head are so precise. I think without them it would be almost impossible to find what it wants to or grab them off the ground from such a distance. Like a little ostrich. Slightly better flyer than a little ostrich, though. It also looks like a snake, though, doesn't it? And I'm sure that's got some kind of function. And if you look at the back of the thing's head, when it's in the grass, it looks like a cobra. So I'm sure that's the function of the black-bellied bustard's coloration on the back of the head. And the yellow, or the red-crested quahan, which is a very closely related bird, also has a similar kind of snake-like arrangement on the back of its head. Right here, on we go. Maybe the queen has now arrived for her breakfast. So as I was saying, many of the animals have dispersed as a result of the rain, which is very nice for them, not quite so nice for us, of course. But what it has meant is that the animals have now, or the grazers and browsers, have retained or regained their nutritional status. They're looking much better, and it's no surprise, therefore, that the Nkuhuma pride, who was really looking very, very ropey when I left here about 2 weeks ago, is now looking fine. So that's really very good news indeed. I became seriously worried at one stage that I'd come back to no lions at all. And they are following tracks of the lions towards the Galago Pan. Keep an eye out here, and just to say to you that there are two very nice leopard orchids around this area that I'm very much looking forward to them flowering, because they're at a height that we can actually reach. I don't have to risk life and limb to fetch one and try and smell it. Because one should smell as many flowers as possible in one's life, I feel. Don't you feel, Jean-André? Don't you think flower smelling is very important? Yes. Jean-André said nothing, of course, which means that he's not entirely in agreement. I must just say, everybody, that Jean-André has got a very impressive moustache that he grew for Movember. He looks a little bit like a biker. Wouldn't you say, is that a biker moustache? Is that what we'd describe it as? Well, you've succeeded. He says it's supposed to look as ridiculous as possible. Absolutely succeeded very, very, very impressively there. Yes. We'll try and get a picture of him when he's not looking, everyone. Would you like to show everybody your moustache, André?
Feeling headless today.
Here we go, everybody. You're in for a treat while we look for the queen. All right, there is Jean-André turning the camera, and he's now going to appear. Come on, Jean-André, show us your moustache. Says he hasn't done his makeup, hasn't spruced it enough yet. All right, let's just listen to the birds here for a second. Now, there is a white-browed scrub robin somewhere in here. They're so good at hiding. You can't see it, can you, Jean-André? There it is. No. Yes,
it is.
I
see it up there.
Yeah. You can just see it moving around, exactly sort of in the middle of where Jean-André is looking. You may have just seen a flicker of movement. There's also an apelis in there going. No, it's not an apelis at all. Yes, it is. It's an apelis. Is it? Hang on a second. I can't see that properly. Let me just get my binoculars out. If I didn't know better, I'd say that was a green-backed bleating warbler. I think that's what it is, actually. Green-backed bleating warbler. Now called green-backed Camaroptera. Is it? No, I've lost my mind. Hang on a second, everyone. I think it is. Let me just find this bird.
Can you see the scrub robin?
I can't see the scrub robin, no. I mean, the robin is so close by and so loud. It is a green-backed Camaroptera, that is correct. And I'll just show the two of them to you. There's the green-backed Camaroptera there. And I'm pretty sure that's what it was. And the only other one it could be, which has a very similar call, is the yellow-breasted Apalus there. And they sometimes don't really have that bright yellow breast. But I'm pretty sure that it's the other one. Marvellous. Right. Pajamas is out on foot and hopefully not walking too close to where Karula was. Let's go and find out what her plans are for the next couple of hours.
Very good morning to all of you, and welcome to the on-foot portion of this morning's Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Eggsy, also officially known as Zunder, on camera with me. And we have the wonderful Aubrey, acting as security detail and spotter extraordinaire. Now, we are going to be avoiding the spot where Karula has hoisted that baby impala. Well, we're assuming it's Karula. I think it's a relatively safe assumption, though. But speaking of sort of close encounters and interesting things, look who was sleeping here at some point last night. We've got a track here of where an animal stretched itself out, and actually a few of them stretched themselves out some point last night, probably actually closer to early this morning. And somewhat very conveniently, they have in fact left their footprints in order for us to determine what was sleeping here. And it was the entire Nkuhuma pride that has walked past our camp at some point in the evening. And just to give you a perspective as to how close and where we live, our camp, you've seen where Karula is, or you would have seen, James showed you, I was in final control. He showed you roughly where Jerry and Rebecca were sitting in final control. We have quite literally just walked out, and in fact, there's the no entry sign into the back end of our camp. So into the staff village and the surrounding areas, which obviously the lions paid attention to. They actually paid heed to the no entry side, and they didn't actually enter. They just stopped and lay down right outside and then continued on. Apparently Brent is on their tracks towards the Galago water pan, or the water hole. And we've got the whole pride walking here, and the first thing I just wanted to show you quickly while we're here with this track is just the sort of the scuff marks. Now, animals, when they lie down, are usually very, very convenient in that they step in the middle of where they've been lying down. Sometimes it's a little bit nondescript. You've just got vague sweeping marks. You can actually, although the light is quite difficult, and I'm not sure if you'll be able to see it, but you can actually see the imprints of the hare from where they've been lying. And this was probably front paws over here. A sweeping, you know how the lions often turn, cup their paws from side to side, toss and curve them a little bit. This was where one of the lionesses was lying, and then she stepped right in the middle of her track as she got up. So you can imagine her standing, getting into a sitting position, maybe stretching, and then walking along. Now, what I wanted to show you, I'm going to try and find a clear example. One of them lay here as well. What I'm trying to find you, although there has been a little bit of vehicle traffic, is how big our cubs' tracks have gotten. Hold on, let me... Sorry, we're reversing. We're going back. Sorry, eggs. Here we go. Oh, no, son, don't do this to me. I'm trying to show you a track and the sun's disappeared. That's very, very inconsiderate of it. I'll have to try and outline it for you because it's going to be very difficult for you to see. Can you see this track here, eggs? Kinda. This is one of our cub tracks. Now, a couple of months ago when we were seeing them, they were tiny, tiny. And this is one of the little ones. This is one of the youngest ones. Probably the little one with the floppy ear, just judging by its size. So this is the outline. There's this little back pad. There's its little toesies. Can you sort of see that? It's sort of a track, but it gives you a nice perspective as to how much bigger their feet have got over the last few months. They're nearly, I mean, this is the tiniest of them, and they're almost getting to the point that their feet are as large as lionesses, and that's the joy of cubs. Their feet grow much faster. In fact, a lot of baby animals, rhino, are exactly the same. Thoroughly entertaining. They walk around with these clown feet for the first few months of their lives, and particularly cubs. And we're going to be keeping an eye out to see whether or not we encounter either the more lion tracks, or in fact, if we see any tracks of Karula and her adorable cubs. But while we carry on and continue our walk and dodge around Karula, let's go over to Byron so that he can update you on his progress for the morning.
Oh dear. So no update from us just yet. We've been having a good look around, trying to find any sign of the Nkuhuma pride, but I've had no luck just yet. Maybe... Oh, they could be around here somewhere. Morning, Brent. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How's it going?
How's everyone doing?
Good, good, good.
Hello, Bebop.
Hello.
You missing me yet?
I am.
Oh, Brian.
Oh, killer bees. Killer bees.
Hi.
Brent's driving guests at the moment, everyone. Can you believe he's been trusted with guests?
Someone's got to do it.
Someone's got to do it. We'll see you later.
Did you go down to the hyena
then? No, I didn't go. Okay, yeah. Okay. I'm going to continue driving around. Enjoy your morning, everyone. Good luck. So there are a few of us now searching for these lions, which is great. It does help a lot and it does make it a bit easier, but I really am not sure which direction they've gone in, and it's a bit difficult for us to try and get off and track while we are on camera, obviously. This pride's definitely in this area somewhere, and who knows, if they made a kill, they could potentially be in one of these blocks somewhere, resting and maybe feeding on something, and they'll stay there until they finish that kill. So we don't know. We heard them last night. We heard one or two males calling during the course of the evening, but they could be anywhere. They could be anywhere. They do move around quite a lot, but I'm hoping we'll get to find them this morning at some point. And it appears as if the cloud cover's breaking up a bit. So I think I was right with not getting any rain this morning on game drive. But you never know. I never chance the weather. But surprisingly enough, we haven't seen too much animal activity this morning. I've seen some impala, and I saw two dacre darting off very quickly, but not much else. As I say that, there's some more impala. Just a few impala, but I think of a few weeks ago where we had all those buffalo around, we had elephants around, because Juma had gotten some early rains and the vegetation was green. and good for those animals. But now with all the rainfall we've had all over, animals have just dispersed, and it happens in summer. They move into areas that they wouldn't normally be in because there is food and water around. So it does happen, but they will still pass through these areas at some point. And while we continue our search for lions, let's head over to James and get an update from him and the leopards he was trying to follow.
Look at that wonderful leopard that we have there. Leopard orchid, of course, and that is the oldest joke in the bush next to the flying banana, which, of course, is the yellow-billed hornbill. But fear not, everybody. We are not here to show you a leopard orchid. We are here to show you a leopard. And there is little Hosanna, as far as I can tell, sitting on a dead tree, perched magnificently in the morning light. And he's not too close to where the kill was, and he's, I don't know who else is around here. I don't know if Karula's here. He does keep looking down towards the ground. I'm just going to quickly call Brent in. I don't know that he's heard me call this. Brent, do you copy, Brent? Brenty, we did relocate the young male on Rebecca's in the drainage line just on the western side of the road. I'm just going to move forward, everyone, so we can just have a look, see what he's looking at. Poor Johan has been much like us, looking, hopefully, for these leopards. Now let's just keep an eye on this termite mound here and in the drainage line down below for the others. We know, of course, that leopards are very clever at hiding. Say when you've got a picture, Jean-Marie. Is that right? A little bit? A little bit further? We'll stop there before we frighten him. Isn't that cool? He looks very relaxed on his tree here. Now, what Jandre was saying to me the other day was that, who are you with, Jandre? Brent or Byron. But Karula went back to fetch the cubs to a kill, and she then killed something else on the way back. And so I wonder if that isn't the case here. I think it's probably going to happen quite a lot while the little impala lambs are around the place. Isn't this just a wonderful picture? We'll do a little bit of a turn around the termite mound to see if either of the others are here. But he's panting, you know, he's breathing relatively heavily, and I wonder if they haven't eaten something fairly recently. In fact, I'm pretty sure they have. So I don't think they're very hungry. That is just wonderful. We're sitting now, what, Jandre, about, I don't know, 5 meters from him, maybe? 7.1 meters, thank you very much, as he looks down on us. And I'm pretty sure, at the very least, Shongile is somewhere around here. Lucy, very nice one from you. Of course, we're always worried when we see these cubs on their own. They're 10 months old as of yesterday. And you say, would he be in danger without his mum around from any of other predators? Yes, he could be. But, you know, he's almost the same size as Karula now. And so physically, he's not much less capable than she is. Obviously, he doesn't have the experience, though, and so what he has to watch out for is his lack of understanding and experience and his naturally over-curious young male leopard sort of characteristics. On this tree, though, the only thing that could have a go at him would be another leopard. Or a lioness could get up there, but she'd probably be quite nervous to go to the end of the branch where he's sitting. This is just a wonderful picture. That's just your hun moving into position. He looks, you see, he's looking around the place. I wonder if there isn't something else or someone else around. And all around the birds are calling. What a perfect, perfect way to begin our morning. Well, to sort of have the middle of our morning, shall we say. Isn't that cool? Oh, hang on. What was that? Something just shot out of the bushes to where he's looking. Don't know what it was. Could easily be one of the others. Maybe it's Shongile after some squirrel breakfast. He's just the picture of relaxation though, isn't he? Saturday morning, taking a load off on the weekend. Yeah, Brenda, I have to agree with you. You say he got so big. You said for a second you almost confused him with Sandile. He's not quite that big yet, but Brenda, from where we spotted him, what was it, probably at about, 40 metres or so, I looked and I thought young male leopard, that was the first thing I thought. And once that starts to happen, you know that he's just getting that shape of a young male. His head is getting big. His head is the size of his mother's now. He's maybe not quite as tall as her. His feet are the same size, definitely, if not bigger. Yeah, that foot is about the same size. And you can see he's panting, he's been eating. They have been on a kill somewhere and are perhaps in transition towards their new kill. How very lucky we have been. I'm just going to scan around and see if I can't spot some spots. Now, Marco, aka Siberia Zumi, you were wondering about at what age they will develop the full roar or chuff. Well, the chuff is different from the roar. The chuff is that chuffing sound, the chuff sound that they make. I think they probably do that already. The full sort of full-throated roar, I imagine, will probably only be fully there around about 2 years, but they won't use it. He won't use that until he's probably 4 or 5 when he starts to take a territory. Before that, it'd be very dangerous for him to use it. So the animals, the vocal animals that we do see, of course, the young lions, which have a very similar kind of vocal arrangement, they don't have deep-sounded roars until they're much older, until they're at least, say, 18 months to 2 years old. And they've still got that kind of whiny noise that they make. He is posing magnificently. Chandra, could you go and move those branches from in front of his face? I can't drive forward because I will bash this bush. We could go around the other side. In fact, let's do that. Let's move gently around the other side there, and I think we might also get a better view of whether there isn't another leopard around. Please don't move, Hosanna. Right, in the meantime, while we move around, let's go and find out how Pajamas is doing on foot and what her plans are for the next little while. I know that I was supposed to tell you what she's looking for, but I failed to hear what it was, so she will do that for you.
Well, it's not so much what we're looking for as what we found. And I'm speaking quite softly because this particular creature is very, very sensitive to the sound of vibrations and the sound of voices. Inside this massive hole is one of my absolute favorite spiders, and she's just gone back in. She would have been out and about hunting during the night, and she's just gone back into her hole, which is her preferred spot. She only has one hole that continues to grow throughout her life, and it is a type of spider known as a baboon spider. Now, the baboon spider is the South African equivalent of the tarantula. They're big, hairy spiders with very big, strong, powerful jaws. And they are exceptionally special spiders, in my opinion. They're old world spiders. They are very basic in design. They don't come with venom, just powerful, powerful jaws. Now, she's just gone to bed, and I'm popping a piece of grass in there, and hopefully she's going to shift it out. Here she goes. She's moving it around. It's not just the wind. That's her moving it to try and get it out. And if I were to touch it now, there's actually an incredibly powerful pull on the end of this grass. And it's like she's grabbed it and she doesn't want to let go. Hey, girl, can I have my grass back? Hey? No, not so much. Now, she is very, very shy. And I think that she doesn't want to come out this morning. Sometimes you can get them to come right out. They're relatively relaxed spiders. They're quite comfortable with people. But this particular female doesn't want to come out. Now, how do I know that it's a female? Only females make these holes in the ground. The males only have them when they're young. Once they've reached their full age, when they've reached their adult age and are ready to reproduce, they abandon... Oh, she's got it. They abandon their holes, and they start to move about, and they just find hiding places during the day. So it is a nocturnal species of spider. Hey, girl, do you want to come say good morning? Hello, my girl. I can see her, but unfortunately, if Eggsy tries to show you into the hole, she'll go back further in. She'll go deeper. So I'm not going to stress her out. I was going to see if she would come out. Come on, girl. It's okay. You can come. We won't hurt you. Now, this is probably a horned baboon spider. I'll give it one more try. Oh, nope. She let go. Okay. You can actually feel the incredibly powerful tug on the end of the grass. That's her pulling back to see what on earth this is. But I'm going to leave her to her sleep since she doesn't want to come out, and I'm not going to try and force the issue. So we'll leave her be and we'll carry on. In the meantime, let's go over to Byron for an update.
And finally, we do have an interesting update. Look at this, everyone. We've managed to find the Nkuhuma Pride with a lot of help from Brent as well, who's been out on safari, as you saw earlier. So fortunately, all of us working together, we managed to find them. This is great. The whole pride is here. It appears as if all 5 lionesses and all 6 cubs are around at the moment. This side over here, I can just see 2 big lionesses and what appeared to be 5 cubs. And then if you look over to my left, you can see, and I'll just double check with my binoculars, there is the other cub in the middle, and then 3 lionesses over here too. So that is wonderful, the whole pride together. And it's great to, I don't know which way to turn now, there are lions everywhere. So this is really, really fantastic. And just shows you, you know, when was it? Was it yesterday? Shucks, now I'm trying to think. Yesterday and the day before we had the one coalition member, the one Birmingham male, that was with the one lioness from the pride, and they've split up already. So I don't think they were really mating. I'm not sure. I mean, we didn't really see any mating activity. I think he was trying to see if she was perhaps an estrus and ready to mate. But I didn't see it, and I don't think anyone else saw any mating. They could have mated during the course of the evening, perhaps, but I'm sure if they were mating properly, it would have occurred while we were with them and would have happened fairly regularly, as lion mating does occur. But she's obviously found the pride again. The rest of the pride joined up with them, and I don't see any sign of the males at the moment. You never know. There could be one lying in the thicket somewhere close by, and I will keep scanning just to make sure I don't see one. But for the moment, it looks like it's just the pride. And we know those males, as a coalition does, when they move around, they will cover huge distances and they'll split away from the pride at times to go and potentially find females from another pride, or just to patrol their territory and make sure that no other lions are coming in and challenging them. So they'll meet up with one another. The males patrol certain parts of the territory, raw, scent mark, and then at some point meet up with the females again. But I'm so glad we got to find the pride. And, you know, we've been speaking about it now for the last week or so, and we were very fortunate. I'm trying to think. It was about... Five days ago, I think, about 5 days ago, we managed to spend some time with the pride, the Unkuma pride, and it must have been kind of late afternoon, and the cubs got up and started playing, and we got that amazing sighting with them all playing and tackling and stalking one another, and just being playful cubs. And then the lionesses later on did very much the same thing, also ran, pounced on one another, chased each other. It was incredible to see. Now, we've been very concerned, obviously, with the few diseases that the pride has contracted during the drought, but it appears, and I say it appears, so because I'm not entirely sure if they have completely recovered, but it appears as if they are doing very, very well. They seem healthy. They seem like they're moving a lot better, and it's fantastic for the pride. So I think, again, I don't want to jinx anything and say something that could potentially change in a day or two, but for the moment, they're looking healthy, they're looking good, and that's wonderful for the pride. Nice and peaceful sitting around these lions now. Listening to all the birds, some white-browed scrub robins in the distance. I can hear some lilac-breasted rollers. You might be able to pick up on the harsh call of the roller. And then also a magpie shrike. I think that's a pretty good magpie shrike call. What do you think, Brian?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
It's always nice sitting around lions and listening to what else is going on. What else is going on in the bush? I'm going to spend a little bit of time with these lions and just see if they do decide to move. And while I do that, let's head back to James and get an update on the little leopard that he had.
The little leopard, everybody, was spotted by some impala, and he's through there. And I mean, I don't know where he's going or where he thinks he's going. But I don't, you know, we're going to be quite sensitive about how we follow him. because he's now on his own. And the impala started shouting at him, and then he moved. He obviously didn't want to be and have his presence announced. They're still shouting. And we'll just see if... I wonder if they haven't spotted another one, except he wouldn't have moved if there'd been another leopard. Did you see exactly where he went, Chandri? Straight through, huh? We'll just ease our way through here. And we are going to be very sensitive about following him. So we might lose him, but that's okay. We've had a great sighting. And then we'll head back to the kill. And we've got Johan going around the other side. I just want to see if he doesn't go to ground in the drainage. Mike, a very nice one. I mean, he's now, of course, moving on his own. And you're saying, when do I think he'll start hunting or helping on the hunt with his mum? He will never really be so much of a helper on the hunt. He will just kind of follow gently behind. Go ahead. We can't see him at the moment, Johan. Yeah, we have got him, sorry. He's now static just underneath this big tree. I'm just trying to get a view now. Now he's moving. Yeah, he's in the drainage. You need to get into the drainage, Johan. He's static in the drainage. We'll try and move in there now, everybody. So, Mike, they don't really help on the hunt so much as start to hunt on their own, if you know what I mean. So they don't ever hunt cooperatively like leopards do, at least like lions do. Look, I'm sure they have done it before. And we've certainly seen Tingana and Karula on a relatively large sub-adult leopard, a sub-adult buffalo. And that I don't think they could have killed unless they'd helped each other. Look, he's only about 150 meters to the north of the drainage at the moment, where it crosses Rebecca's. Sorry, everybody, we're just trying to get Brent into the sighting. Where? There. Oh, there. I see him now. Right, hold on, watch your heads, everybody. Let's just see if we can't get a view. I can see him. We'll just show you where he is. We'll just show you his head popping up through the bush there. There we are. But in the meantime, look, we'll try and get one little view again. But if he moves again, I'm not going to try and follow him, I don't think. Just simply because he's a little bit young. And then we'll head back towards the kill and see what's going on there. So Johan's moving in at the moment. And I'm just going to let him to move. I'm just going to let him to move. That's wonderful English. I'm just going to let him move. And then when he's switched off and got a view, we'll stop and move again. Such a gorgeous morning. Temperature is perfect. Gentle breeze, birds calling, and golden leopard in the middle of the bush. Dale, you're a relatively new viewer. I think I spoke to you yesterday for the first time. You want to know how long Karula will leave the cubs for at any one time? And the answer, Dale, is it's really difficult to say how long. And it's also interesting that as they get older, of course, that period will increase and he will actually separate himself every so often from the mother and his sister. So, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't imagine much longer than 48 hours. right. Johan, stop moving, so I'm going to move a little bit closer. We'll try and get one last view. Otherwise, we've had a wonderful time with him so far. Peer into the drainage line here and see if there isn't a mum and a daughter. They're all having some girl time, Jean-André, you see that? Now, R.T. Lofelt, you've asked an interesting question about whether leopards like lions roar from the diaphragm. Not really sure what you mean there, R.T. Lofelt. A lion and a leopard have a very similar structure of... I'm going to run these tamburti trees over. They are protected trees. They have a very similar structure to the larynx or vocal cords and the apparatus that holds those vocal cords in place. And, you know, they blow air through that apparatus in much the same way that we blow air through our vocal cords in order to make them vibrate. And so I'm not sure what you mean by from the diaphragm. The sound, there's definitely no sound coming from the diaphragm. The diaphragm, of course, is used to contract the lungs and push air out of them. And if you are a loud roaring animal, that obviously happens a lot more, it happens a lot more forcefully than it does in other animals. There we go. How's that, Jean-André? Don't say I don't ever do anything for you. Is that right for you? There. Not ideal, is it? It'll do for now. Forward. Yes, good idea. There you go. Stick in the ear now. Stick in the ear or leaf on the nose. There we go. Gorgeous. So he moved, he's probably moved about, say 150 meters, 450 feet. So, I mean, the radius in which his sister and mother could be is quite wide. It's so interesting that those lions are exactly where they have been so many times in the last little while. Gail, you say it's because his sister's not around, is there a chance that he's lost? No, I don't think so. He knows exactly where he is. I think his mum and his sister will be close by somewhere. I remember Brent had a long sighting of her, not him, and for 2 hours he sat with this little leopard. And right, not this little leopard, the sister, and right at the end of the sighting, he popped up from nowhere. So it really wouldn't surprise me at all to find that she was very close by. But interesting, the reason he moved there was because those impala were alarm calling. They were starting to advertise his presence, which made him feel uncomfortable. He knew that instinctively. And now he's moved off to where he can lie in the shade. You see how heavily he's breathing? That is purely a function of the fact that he's got a fat, full belly. And he's gold, eh? He's much golder than his mother, I think. Amber, have you ever had a huge Sunday lunch or after your Thanksgiving dinner, perhaps? You say, why do they pant after they are, after they've eaten? They pant because their stomach cavity is very full. They can eat proportionately much more of their body mass than we can. And so with a big, fat, full stomach like that, it pushes up against the diaphragm, makes it difficult to expand the chest cavity. So that's one reason. So they have to take shallow breaths. The other reason is that apparently the extra oxygen pumping through and over the blood vessels that line the digestive tract help them to digest a bit quicker and absorb the nutrients that they need to. So they need that oxygenated blood to be pumping around the digestive tract, and that helps them to absorb the nutrients that they need to. We're going to see if we can catch up with him. While we do that, let's head across to Jamie Patterson and find out what she has for you on her little delicate ballerina feet.
What a fantastic way to start off a morning than spent in the company of one of our favorite little leopard cubs. One of our few little leopard cubs, actually, to be honest. But still, I'm a little bit jealous of James and having his time spent with the character that is Hosanna. Just missed it. Drat. Now, this morning, we've been searching for various things. We're actually on our way back to where the Boomslang and the two white-faced Scops owls were with Byron yesterday. I'm very, very keen to see them. Aubrey's going to be leading us on our way there. But, of course, we're stopping to look at various things. And now that I've stopped to look at them, they're all vanishing. We're attracted to the sound of buzzing. Oh, come back. Buzzing around this particular tree. There you go, Eggsy, can you see it there? And closer inspection, this tree is filled with African honeybees. They used to be called African killer bees, which is a name that we never use in South Africa because, of course, it gives them a terrible reputation, and people start to think that there is something to be exterminated or to be got rid of in some way, which is absolutely not on, really. Bees are incredibly, vitally important to the way in which ecosystems function and for the pollination of various plants, including all crops. So with the disappearance of bees comes the disappearance of humans, essentially, or at least a very, very different life to the one that we know. They've got this reputation as killer bees because they're very protective and they swarm. I have grown up with these little chaps. Sorry, Eggs, I'm trying to look at these ones here. That's going to be next to impossible. I've grown up with these bees flying around, going into my cold drinks or my soft drinks when I was a kid. I have been stung many, 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 many times. I'm not allergic, so I'm not concerned about standing here. I don't even react to them at all. It hurts for a bit and then it goes away, which is rare for me. It's not often that I'm not allergic to something, but luckily bees not, because I have actually had one in my mouth before. My mom told me a story once when I was a little girl, and how I was sitting in her shopping trolley and a bee came in and went up my nose and then came out again, then went into my mouth and came out again and went up my nose. She said I didn't move a muscle, I just sat there like a little statue. Luckily I didn't get stung, so there you go. But they are very valuable, and what I'm trying to work out is why on earth they're all in this tree, because I can't see any flowers. I can start to... let's see if I can figure out... sorry, let me just duck around here. Perhaps there is a bud or two coming through, but I don't see much. No, not really. So I'm not sure what they're after unless their beehive is in here, somewhere in the hollow of the tree. I can't find it if it is, but it is an interesting sight to see. So the African honeybee, exceptionally valuable, very, very important in our ecosystem, and not at all that dangerous. I remember vaguely my brother running along when he was on the sports field, and suddenly everybody just dropped. My dad was on his way to pick him up with me, and we thought it was some kind of sports training exercise. I think they were playing hockey. He thought it was some sort of a sports training exercise, but it turned out to be a swarm of bees that flew overhead. But other than that, we haven't had any... never had any major bee incidents. Eggsy, you said you're not allergic, huh? Well, you're not sure. Not allergic. Steph and Dave are, of course, which is why when the honey guide led them to the beehive, they were not so keen on getting all that close, which is understandable. That's the last thing we need. Oh, and Jerry's allergic. Are you allergic to bees as well, Jerry? Shame. That must have been unfortunate for you. My brother's very allergic to them. Now, moving on from bees and onto other creepy crawlies, we were looking earlier at the hole of the baboon spider. This is something completely different, and it is in fact a scorpion burrow. Now, it's nice to compare the two because they're both, of course, they're both arthropods. They're both arthropods. They're both arthropods, and both, of course, they are arachnids. And it's interesting to see with the burrowing types of both scorpion and spider the way in which they go about things. Now, scorpions are much better at digging than spiders are. So the baboon spider stays in her hole her entire life and she excavates it as she grows. Scorpions are very good at digging new burrows, and you can actually see this one's been doing plenty of maintenance. You can, if you look closely, you can actually see the tracks of where her footprints, or his footprints, could be both, have fallen, and actually scrape marks of the tail and the claws as this particular scorpion has excavated its burrow. Now this is probably, it's a big scorpion, judging by the shape and judging by the size, probably an Opisthocampus, one of the Opisthocampus species. Now the difference in terms of baboon spiders, I want to try and draw, but the light isn't really all that appropriate. The difference between baboon spiders and scorpion burrows, if you imagine that this is the surface of your ground, I don't know how clearly that's coming through. Is that coming through clearly, eggs? Yeah. That's the surface of your ground. A baboon spider hole basically goes like this, with a little chamber at the end, and that's where the spider's sleeping. So when that blade of grass went down, touched in the entrance to her chamber, and she grabbed it with her chelicera, or her jaws. Scorpion burrow, this is not the ideal drawing implement. A scorpion burrow, if this is the entrance here, goes like this. It goes down here, then it goes down here, then it goes down here. It zigzags down into the dirt so that the scorpion's here. So when you watch something, or maybe even here, so what will happen is sometimes you'll see a dwarf mongoose or a honey badger digging out a scorpion. You'll often find that they end up digging at an angle. So if the scorpion burrow or chamber is here, they'll often dig down in that direction to try and dig out a scorpion, rather than digging just straight down. And that's why they do that. And that's why the chamber of the scorpion is zigzag like that. It's slightly harder for them to get into. Well, it sounds as though the bigger cat's success is continuing. Let's head over to Byron to see which lions he's found.
So I've just tried to reposition slightly to show you these lions again from a different angle, and we're still sitting with the pride, but they have not been moving at all. And you can see the big lioness resting over here, and the others are still lying not too far. I think all that would possibly happen is the sun is starting to creep through now, which is wonderful. So I think if these lions are a little bit exposed, as it starts warming up, they're probably going to move into the shade a bit more, perhaps even down to the drainage line. It doesn't look like they're going to move anytime soon, but having said that, you never know. And as we know with lions, if they do come across something or hear something interesting or something close by that they could potentially hunt, they will indeed hunt. I think this pride is going to stay in this area for the day. Matrix, you'd like to know how lions remove those thorns out of their paws. And thorns or ticks or anything that gets stuck around the paws. So if you have a look at that little cub cleaning itself now, that is one way that they'd be able to remove thorns or ticks or anything like that. They've got very, very rough tongues. They're almost barbed. They've got tiny little hairs on them, very, very rough. And they'll be able to turn their paws around and clean their paws. And they'll also use their teeth. Sometimes they bite the thorns out or the ticks if they're sitting on them. So that would be the best way to get thorns out. Also, those pads are pretty thick, so it's not easy for thorns just to go into the pad. But yeah, the best way would be just, and I've seen it while lions are walking, occasionally they stand on something sharp, little thorn, and they turn their paw around quickly and just lick it, and they're able to lick that thorn out. Let's just have a look here. I think I see a bit of movement just off to the left, I think the other cub is coming to join its siblings and these two lionesses. There we go, we'll get a nice view of it. There we go. Maybe feeling a little bit lonely lying on the other side just with the lionesses. Those bellies look quite full, don't they? Look at all that one's belly looks fairly full. So I wonder if they didn't feed on anything last night. There's a possibility, not sure what. I don't see any signs of a carcass in this area, but potentially they did. I'm just looking for some more shade. It's very peaceful sitting watching lions like this, and I find sometimes you can find yourselves almost dozing off a little bit because it's so relaxing, and especially on cool mornings and in winter while you're sitting out and as the sun starts rising and warming things up with that wonderful sunshine on your face, it does become very, very relaxing. And I can actually feel the sun warming us up now too. We're sitting out in the open and it's much warmer than it was earlier this morning. And these lions are enjoying their little snooze. As we know, I mean, they rest like this because they are so active at night and they conserve the energy during the day. So there's no reason for them to necessarily move around too much during the day unless they're looking for water or they are really hungry and looking for food. Sammy, and welcome to you, Sammy. You wanted to know if we ever get nervous around the lions. So no, Sammy, I don't. And the thing is, over years, like this pride, for example, they've been viewed for many, many years on Juma. So they've become somewhat habituated to the vehicles moving around them and getting fairly close to them, but not disturbing them. That's the biggest thing. So we don't disturb them and we don't cause them to feel threatened. So therefore, they probably won't react to the vehicles at all. If I had to drive right up to them, yes, they would get upset and they'd do one of two things, either decide to charge the vehicle and make a noise or run away. So we don't want any of that. So we do view from a distance and we do try to be very respectful of the animals. If we're on foot though, if we were walking, it would definitely be a different experience. And you know, when we do our bush walks and that, we do need to be careful and we do need to be aware. If you bump into lions, usually they give you a lot of warning before you get too close. You might get a few growls, so you can hear them before you might even see them. But if you really surprise them, then one or two things would happen. They'd either charge you or they'd run away. Those are the only two options. Generally speaking, and in my experience of guiding for however long, they generally do prefer moving away from you. They won't necessarily just charge unless they feel very threatened. But no, I don't, on the vehicles, definitely not nervous at all. But in saying that, we are still very careful and I do still watch their behavior, make sure they are comfortable with the vehicles and that they don't feel threatened. Hope that answers your question, Sammy. All right, I think what we are going to do is, we've still got quite a bit of time, so we're going to leave these lions. They seem to be very comfortable and relaxed at the moment. So let's leave these lions. Stay with us though, and we'll see what else we can find. I can hear a lot of woodland kingfishers flying around at the moment. I can't see them. I just caught a glimpse of them flying over us. You can hear that wonderful call in the distance, that beautiful woodland kingfisher. So let's leave these lions, let them rest for a bit. We'll continue. We may return later or this afternoon, but let's see what else we can find while we're out here. What a lovely morning. Sure, nice to see those lions so far, and we've had luck with the leopards. still need our elephant though, so that's what I'm going to try and look for. You never know, it could bump into an Ellie anywhere. Yo, that sun's very bright at the moment. Good morning to you. You're a new viewer, and you wanted to know, do we ever intervene with the animals in these areas, in these game reserves where we are, and do we ever feed animals if they're hungry? So no, Pac, we don't. We don't, not at all. And the reason for that is we are in a completely natural system, a natural environment. And it is tough at times for some people to see, especially when we experience droughts, like we did this year. A lot of the animals lost condition, a lot of animals died because of the drought. But it's nature's way of keeping a balance. This is a completely independent it's a natural ecosystem. It functions naturally. We don't have to interfere, and we are purely here to view the animals. We're not here to interfere, and we need to always remember that. And it is tough, but when I take people on safari all over Africa, we go into these national parks or onto these game reserves that are natural, and the animals move around where they want and do what they want. They're completely wild. They're not introduced. They've always been here. They are born into these areas. They are not introduced animals. So that is why we do not interfere at all. If lions die, if elephant die, if buffalo die because of a drought or anything like that, that is nature's way of keeping a balance, and we need to respect that. And we're purely here to view. We take the good and the bad, which is sometimes not easy, but it is what we are here for. And if, however, an animal was injured because it was caused by human intervention, who knows, maybe a snare or something that we found, we would then bring in a vet, and they would then come and help that animal and remove a snare. But anything that happens naturally to the animals, we do not interfere at all. So while I carry on driving and searching for some elephant, why don't we head back to Jamie on the bushwalk?
The wonderful thing that a bushwalk allows us to do, I mean, obviously in the vehicles, like with Byron, you can get nice up close and personal with things like lions and leopards. But the bushwalk allows us moments with the amazing insect and arthropod life that this reserve has to offer. Like, for example, in the form of this millipede. Now, when last did you actually sit and watch a millipede eat? Because that's exactly what this chap is doing, and it's a fascinating process. Now, he's targeting this small plant. It looks like a little small annual plant. I don't know which one it is. But you can see the way that its feelers at the top of its head, and then its front four sets of feet working together and in tandem to pull the leaf into its mouth. And when he moves on a little bit, you'll actually be able to see the bite marks that he's leaving behind, although I think he might actually devour this entire leaf. And it's fascinating to watch. I've never actually stopped and watched in detail the whole process. And that's the joy of these bushwalks, especially because the camera can get us closer than your eyes might. So you have a chance to pick up on the details that you might not otherwise see. Look at you, you've nearly finished that whole leaf, you greedy guts. You only just started feeding on it when I stopped here. And at first I thought only that it was going to only eat the brand new leaves, but this was a fully mature, fully sized leaf. It was about this size, that leaf that it's currently eating. Now you can see my hands moving around this millipede. and it's not doing anything. Millipedes are not particularly alert creatures. They don't go ducking back into their holes or react in any way, and that's because generally they don't need to. There's not much out here that likes to eat a millipede, and there are things that do eat them, but for the most part, their high content of cyanide has a tendency to discourage most things from eating it, which is fair enough. I think it would act as, you don't want any millipede, do you, Eggsy?
Mm-mm.
No. Yes, fair. Well, a good answer. Oh, onto the next leaf. This is so cool. I've never actually properly examined the mouth parts of a millipede, but now I'm actually seeing the way that they're working together. And these actually got tiny little feeler-like, I don't know if they're legs or feelers, an additional set. And they're actually pulling the food. It's not just the top set. They're actually pulling the food into his mouth. And I'm quite impressed with the speed at which this particular millipede is capable of eating. We never really see them feed. They are, of course, complete vegetarians, unlike their somewhat unpleasant centipede cousins. And sorry, Eggsy, I'm going to disrupt you for a second, because, look here, I'm scared it's going to jump if I try and point it out to you. On the edge of this pile of old impala dung is a jumping spider. Can you see it there?
Just.
It is so perfectly camouflaged. Camouflage, sorry, I don't know what's wrong with my speech pattern. Hey, little guy. Bounce. There he is. I love jumping spiders. I find them thoroughly entertaining. But yes, back to our millipede, and we get... let me just finish off with this jumping spider. Jumping spiders, we get a whole load of different species, and they bounce around, and they're absolutely fascinating. Now, this gentleman, do you mind... Or lady, I'm not... I don't know how to tell the difference between different millipedes. Do you mind, Mr. or Mrs., if I just have a... Can we have a quick look at you? Don't really want to disturb it while it's having breakfast. No, it's not interested in moving off, and I don't really want to grab it and wrench it away. I'd be terribly offended if I was busy having my breakfast and somebody came and grabbed me and moved me away from it. In fact, that person might be at mortal peril if they were to come between me and my breakfast, so I'm not going to do that to the millipede. I'm going to let him finish off. But you can see how comfortable he was. Touched him. Or her, and there was no sign of any kind of a reaction. So quite a large, quite a secure millipede. It's not too concerned about me eating it. If I were to pick it up, it would probably curl up into a defensive ball. But again, that's not really enough to stop a predator's jaws. So it ultimately is the threat of the cyanide and the awful, awful taste that a predator would get when they bite into it. Of course, you get things like civets that will munch away on them. But other than that, and wild dogs. Wild dogs seem to like them. But other than that, they are usually free to go about relatively unimpeded. And every now and again, you see them mating together, which I've recently, not recently, a couple of months ago, after some further research and some help from our viewers, discovered that the mating all happens after the reproductive organs are all after the first four sets of legs. So their reproductive organs, despite what you may think about them being there, because that's how we think of standard anatomy, they are in fact right next to the head. That's why you see them intertwined like that. I'm wondering if this little jumping... No. It is not going to let me get it any closer to the camera. It is absolutely refusing. Oopsie-daisy. Well, we're going to leave our millipede to his breakfast. As I said, it's a nice opportunity to get it really up close and personal. Unfortunately, our snake and our owls were not around. Liz, you wanted to know... if the killer bees that you get in the States are exactly the same as our African bees... You say that you think that they are African bees, honeybees mixed with European bees. That could be the case. I'm not 100% sure. For some reason, I thought that they were exactly the same. But now that you say that they might have been crossed with European bees, that is entirely possible. Humans are, of course, fabled for our hybridization processes and the fact that we mix and combine different species. We do it with crops. So quite possibly. I thought that it was... that they were just African honeybees, the killer bees. But perhaps they are, in fact, mixed with European bees. I'm not 100% sure. But a good question, and I will find out a little bit more about that. I've never actually been to the States, so I trust your opinion a little bit more about in terms of what bees you encounter there. I just know that we have our African honeybees that used to be called killer bees. I know that that in South Africa, at least, we called them killer bees right up until relatively recently, where we stopped doing that, thank goodness, because it's not a good reputation for them to have. Unlike flies, they are not pests. I mean, I know flies are valuable, but somehow I just have a little bit more sympathy when it comes to bees. And you might have noticed, those of you that are sharp-eyed, that I've been clutching three round green balls. And that is the happy sign that summer is on its way and that the marulas are fruiting once again. Unfortunately, these are not nearly ripe and they probably have fallen off the tree too soon for them to ripen. But it's something exciting for us to look forward to in terms of yummy fruit that we get to have. I'm going to discard these as a special surprise treat for some happy animal. And we're going to carry on. In the meantime, let's go over to Byron and see what he has planned for the rest of his sunrise safari.
Not quite an elephant, but a little squirrel, Jamie. We were looking for elephants. That was our plan. But we found a little squirrel bouncing about, two of them, but they very quick and agile. Just disappeared there. Beautiful tree squirrel. That's lovely. Nice to see. It's amazing how quick and agile they are when they run around. No, I don't know. Maybe we can do some birding. I can see lion tracks here, everyone. And to be honest, this looks like the one lioness that I think was with the males yesterday. And it looks like she walked along here to head back to the pride. Because I only see tracks of the one lioness. I don't see signs of a male or anything like that. So I assume that this would have been the lioness that just returned to the pride. She walked all along here. This is quite far from where we left the lions. Maybe 2 or 3 miles. So quite fairly far. And what's that, about 4 kilometers? Oh, the glare is very bright this morning. I don't know why. It's clear skies. Ilana, you wanted to know, would the lionesses mate with the number of males to prevent the cubs from being killed like leopards do at times? Yes, Ilana, they would. And but fortunately for them, say for example the Nkuhuma pride. In this area at the moment we've got the coalition males, the Birmingham males that are around, and they are the fathers of those cubs. Now what the lionesses do is they will mate with a number of males from that coalition, not necessarily just one. And therefore the males also then think, well, these cubs must be mine. But occasionally what can also happen is because the females mate with one male from a pride or from a coalition, if the other brother doesn't mate with the lioness, he may still recognize that that's his bloodline because his brother mated with the females. We have seen lions before where males come into an area, but even though because they probably meet up with that pride regularly and they know that one of the males mate to the females, if they give birth to the cubs, they generally would look after them and they won't harm them. It's only when new males come into an area that it becomes a problem and it becomes a safety issue for those little cubs. But lionesses would definitely go and mate with males from different coalitions at times, if there are more than one coalition around, and different males, so that they all think that it's their cubs and they'll hopefully won't harm them. We're going to make our way towards Biffleshoek Dam, I think. Yeah, why not? We'll go and have a look and see if there's any thirsty animals around. Maybe some interesting bird life around the water. this would probably be the time where if I had guests on safari, I'd most likely find a lovely spot for us to stop, stretch our legs a little bit. We've been on the vehicle for almost 2 hours already. So nice time to stop, stretch the legs, maybe have a cup of coffee, a cup of tea, hot chocolate, and just walk around a little bit. It's nice, you get off, stretch the legs around the vehicle, and then off you go again. Alright, so while I look for, this beautiful bird that's about to land and has right next to us, there it goes. Oh, there it is, hang on. The beautiful magpie shrike. And, let's see if it caught something. Did it catch anything? I'm gonna try and move forward a little bit. There we go, still sitting there. I wonder, it looked like it was trying to hunt insects off the ground. Beautiful, beautiful bird. And speaking of insects on the ground, Jamie has got some termites she'd like to show you.
And there's nothing more fascinating than watching termites, despite the number of times that we do actually settle and watch them. And the nice thing about these cold and somewhat cloudy mornings, although it's not so cold anymore, and the termites are slowly winding down for the day, but on cold and cloudy days, you will actually see a termites gathering together and starting to build their termite mounds. Now, underneath the surface of the soil, there will be an intricate network of and system of tunnels that they have been busy creating. These are the fungus farming termites that are growing up here, so that they're starting the basis of a termite mound. Unfortunately for them, this is not a good place. This is in fact a very bad place because it's right in the middle of a road. But they've already started construction there, and over there in the middle of the road, so they have been trying, but unfortunately for them that is not something that's going to be successful. They're going to have to move their endeavors off ever so slightly. Do you know, they might even be part of that termite mound over there. That's probably where this offshoot comes from. So that's how absolutely massive termite mounds really are. Now what I wanted to show you quickly, many of you will be familiar with it. I use a stick, not my finger. Jandre used his finger the other day and ended up having to bandage it in a plaster because the jaws of the termites are so strong. So here's a soldier. Let's see if he will grab it. Oh, he doesn't want to. The speed with which soldiers react to a potential threat, and they've got these, angry, grab it. The speed with which they react to a potential threat, and of course if one of the workers is in any way injured, the soldiers immediately come out, cluster together, and in the way of a lot of social insects are completely selfless in the risks that they are prepared to take. Now you can see the sun is coming out, so they're going to be going back into the underground very shortly. They've got slightly more pigment than some of the other termites, so they'll be able to last in the sun a little bit longer. Just look at the speed of the reaction of these soldiers. There's launching attacks on the stick. I'm not hurting them, I'm just ever so gently brushing them. But they are also responding to the carbon dioxide that I'm breathing. And I'm not blowing on them, I'm just talking. Oh my word. Whoa. Look at that. That is one serious soldier. Look at the size difference. That is intimidating, my goodness. That is a seriously, seriously intimidating creature. Look at the size of its head. It's basically all head. That is impressive. Now that is a sight you don't often get to see. Moving about the workers, you can really see the difference in size and the difference in the way that these termites are adapted. That is incredible. And you do get different types of soldiers. You do get different types of soldier termites in certain species of termite. Wow, he's incredible. It is incredible. Because they don't, of course, reproduce. That is absolutely phenomenal. Just look at the size difference between the workers, the normal soldiers, and then this brute force. This is, I don't know what we would call this, the elite guard, perhaps, of termites. It's not often that you get to see these guys above ground. They come out when there is a serious, serious threat. It's something like an aardvark, for example, that's come through to dig. Their eyesight is not particularly good. They're just reacting to movement and to motion. But that is incredible. That is absolutely massive. I am not putting my finger anywhere near this gentleman. But he did. Don't you think he arrived like some kind of tank out of a battle scene? Didn't that seem that like some kind of movie with the sort of the real, I don't know how to describe it. You know what I mean, though? It's like some kind of superhero movie or a battle scene where they bring out their elite weapon. Now, Lucy, you wanted to know why they react to carbon dioxide. It's an evolutionary thing. It's an evolutionary technique in order to allow them to respond to the threat of something like an aardvark. So an aardvark's digging, and as it's digging into the termite mound, it's puffing. And at the same time, all of the termites are releasing their pheromones, the ones that are under attack and that are being eaten. And that in turn is enough to, the combination of carbon dioxide and the pheromones released by the dying termites is enough to bring out these bad boys. And what a bad boy he is. It is. Let's be more specific. Amazing. And Brenda, you say if this one is that big, the queens must be absolutely enormous. And of course you are correct. The queen sits deep beneath the ground in a safe chamber somewhere, where she is probably about this big, to give you an idea. Absolutely massive, and of course producing many, 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 many termites each and every single day. Her job is to be fed and to lay eggs. And there will be workers and soldiers and all sorts of things. And then, of course, very soon we're going to have the allate breeding season. They're still reacting. They are still reacting. I don't... They're not going to bite me, but the soldiers have basically formed a ring around the outside, around the workers, with this chap obviously being the scariest of them all. Although he's now sort of slipped back into the seething mass of the normal workers. Oh, don't do that, Ant. That was one ant that nearly met a disastrous end. Now, I just want to show you something, just because camouflage is an incredible thing, and I don't think Eggsy's seen it, and the only reason I've seen it is because I'm at the right angle to see it. Eggs? Look here, okay, the ant nearly crawled over it. Look over there, in that patch of sand. Can you see that there? You got it. How's that for camouflage? It's a grasshopper. And it is a completely and utterly hidden. So camouflaged. Bounce. There it goes there. How cool is that? It's absolutely awesome. But I'm still fascinated by Tank Man over here. It's the vast difference in size and just that huge head. Imagine how heavy that head must be on such a, not a scrawny body, it's still a bigger body than the rest of them. But just to show you, gently do it. Oh, they're actually not reacting so much to carbon dioxide. It's obviously because I've been sitting here for a while and they've realized that I'm not actually actively eating them. You can, if you are desperate, eat termites. You've got to do so carefully, obviously, with great caution, because if you eat too many of them at the same time, you're going to end up with a very runny tummy. Our bodies are not really built for digesting them. It's the speed of the soldier. Launches its attack and clasps its jaws against this leaf. And they're strong. I can feel the pull. Not all of them do it, though. It's only some. What was I talking about? Oh, yes. If you eat too many termites, they taste like peanut butter, but in a very insecty kind of way. I'm not a fan. I was forced to eat some as part of an initiation many years ago into bush life. But they will upset your stomach if you eat too many. But they are a very valuable source of protein if you do find yourself without anything else to eat. And of course, there are lots and lots of them, so you don't need to worry about having a huge impact. Now, Emros, speaking of bitey things, you want to end from the sort of the conversation of the killer bees, you want to know whether or not we have any fire ants here. We don't have fire ants, but we have something very similar. Well, it's not, they don't quite swarm in the same way that fire ants do, but we have an ant called a pugnacious ant. And as by its name you might have guessed, it's particularly pugnacious and actually quite foul-tempered. And once one starts to bite you, if you swat it, if you squash it, you're in big trouble, because the rest of them are coming for you, and they're coming for you in a big way. And you end up, they usually come out after rain, and you end up doing a little dance, especially if you're barefoot or wearing sandals. It's very entertaining to watch people dance their way down a road or dance their way away from those ants or animals. Actually, shame, poor Lexi once lay down in a nest of pugnacious ants. She didn't do that again. She went racing. Lexi, by the way, is my Weimarana. But she went racing away at high speed. Now, we're going to leave our termites and this monster termite, since they will very shortly be going back to bed. In the meantime, let's find out what luck James has had with our royal family.
Well, the one interesting piece of luck that we did have, everybody, was that we went and found some tracks down in the southeast over there. And I have to be brutally honest and tell you, I don't know whose tracks they were. They were of a smallish leopard, but could have been Hosanna's. I think they were too small for his. They could have been Karula's. I personally think they were too small for hers too. They could have been Shadow's. I think they're slightly too small for that, which only leaves Shongile. Now, I followed them on foot for a little while, and then I heard some baboons in the block there. And I wonder if the fact that they've split apart like this, that Hosanna is still on his own, is a function of perhaps them being split up by a troop of baboons. We know that baboons are not their best friends in the whole world. And so maybe that's what the case is. Anyway, what I'm going to do now is head back towards the kill site. I haven't been there at all since the beginning of the drive. I'm quite pleased that we didn't sit there and wait, because that would have been quite boring, wouldn't it, Jandre? Yes, indeed. There is a dung beetle here, Jandre, well spotted. Look how well I've parked. Can you see it, Jandre? Why aren't you filming it? Why aren't you filming the dung beetle? Now, I just love this because they orientate themselves so magnificently well. See? He's going exactly the same direction that he was. See, now he's going to orientate himself again. Just find out if he's going the right way. There we are. You're doing all right, fellow. I will put you down again. Can you still see this?
Yes.
He knows something's up. Isn't that cool? This is a plum-coloured dung beetle. There, he's orientating, and now he's going the same direction. Right, I'll put him down here if he wants to go this way. You see that one, obviously. Isn't that cool? Now he's got himself hopelessly lost. He's now looking, and off he goes. Anyway, he's decided that's the way he wants to go. I think that's such fun. Go and dig himself a hole, put it down in there, and with any luck, well, it's probably her, actually. In fact, it's almost certainly her, because there's only one dung beetle there. So she's probably laid her egg in there, and she'll go and find a spot that is safe, bury the ball, and then off she'll go and find some more dung. It looks like a rather strange place, yes. You want to move out? Isn't that amazing? There we go. I mean, the mass of that, that's like you kind of pushing, I don't know, almost half a car behind you. I'm afraid this dung beetle's appreciation of the word of Physics is not very good. Cindy, you're wondering what the weight difference is between the dung beetle and the ball. I would say that that dung beetle is probably about an eighth the mass of the ball. I actually can't watch this. I find it too distressing. I mean, that is ridiculous. No ways! How cool is that? I think she's going to bury it there. She is. Look at that. She's now digging the hole. No. And she could be. What they do is they dig kind of underneath it and around it, and it slowly it kind of sinks into the ground, and I think that's what she's going to do here. That is so cool. So that's where she's decided to bury it. Well done. Clever little dung beetle. And looks quite big there on the screen, doesn't it, compared with when it was on my hand. So it's only about that big, only about an inch across, and the beetle about that big. Very nice. On we go. We're going to take one last turn. Hosanna's over here, so we'll just see if he is visible from the road. I don't want to, like I said, I don't want to spend too much time with him. Just give him a bit of time to settle on his own. But we'll see if we can't find mum and daughter. Didn't find any further tracks, though. Oh, sorry, Aina. I mean, I'm kind of assuming, because I've told the story a few times, that most of you will have known this, but many of you wouldn't have heard the story, of course. You want to know why it is that the dung beetles have the dung. What do they do with it? Well, the first thing they do with it is eat it. That's the main function of the dung for them. But then what they do is that a dung beetle like that, a male will make a ball, and with it he will attract his lady friend, and they will sort of move away from the dung pile as a couple, and there over a delicious meal of new and fresh dung they will consummate their love. And eventually he will then leave her, having kissed her lightly on both cheeks, and she will fly off back to a dung pile, make another ball and lay an egg in the middle of it, and that's what that one was there. And she will then move that off, bury it under the ground, and the egg will hatch in its food, and it will eat the dung, and then it will pupate. It comes out as a sort of white worm like that, and it will then pupate into a beetle and fly off, and the whole process will begin again. Gendre, the song that you wish to sing now is, of course, the Circle of Life, is what he wants to sing. That is the circle of the dung beetle's life. Right, yes, I was joking. Please don't start singing. It would be much better if you didn't. No, stop now. Don't be silly. Viola, you're wondering if that is the same as a rhino beetle. It is similar. It's the same order, and a rhino beetle certainly is a dung beetle, but not all dung beetles are rhino beetles. That makes sense. Now you'll hear the gentle strains, of course, of Elton John's classic. There we go, thank you. Thank you, Gendre. Okay. Jerry, have we got the crickets cued yet? Bobby, you're wondering about whether or not dung beetles prefer one of the cardinal points to roll their dung in. No, I don't think so. I don't think they're like north, south, east or west. I think that they select a spot, though, perhaps before they roll the dung. That's why they're orientating on top of the ball. So I think that they know round about where they're going to take the ball before they go. But I don't think they necessarily prefer going north, south, east or west. Otherwise, if they did, of course, we'd find all dung beetles concentrated towards one direction. No, I'm not seeing any impala around where the tree of death is. That's a good thing. For us, anyway. The woodland kingfisher singing cheerfully as the morning progresses. No, there's the impala is still there, but there's no leopard in the tree. We will go and have another look closely. Isn't that interesting? I think she's definitely got to kill somewhere else. Maybe she was on a territorial patrol yesterday, and leopards are known for doing this. They will have caches or pantries. They will keep a pantry. Hello, Anna Banana. Anna Banana, you want to know if something like that sort of hapless antelope there, I'm just looking under this shaded tree here. No, there's nothing there. Will provide more concentrated nutrients than an adult will. Anna Banana, I don't think so. Maybe slightly different nutrients, given that it's been on a concentrated diet of milk for the last week. But I don't think that they are more concentrated, no. I think the protein is pretty much the same. Obviously, the muscles are slightly different, given that the animal is very young. But I really don't think that it's necessarily any... I don't think it's substantially different. I certainly don't think it's more concentrated, just because it's a young animal. Definitely will be more tender, of course. Anyway, nothing going on here. I think we'll just carry on. We might go back to Little Horsehanna at some stage. I find this very interesting. I wonder if the leopard isn't in the same block where, at least his mum, isn't in the same block where he was found earlier today. Maybe we should go and have a look at Treehouse Dam. It's not a bad idea. Let's head down that way. For the last little while, but we'll go around the other side of quarantine just in case she pops out there. Oh, there's a... Is that a green pigeon, Gendry? Best part of seeing a green pigeon, Gendry, is the joy of saying the word pigeon. It is a green pigeon. Look at it. There it is. Do you enjoy saying the word pigeon, Gendry? Not particularly. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Well.
Not one of my favourite hobbies.
There is the green pigeon. He's quite a splendid fellow, she is, sorry. Or he. Been looking for jackalberries and other fruits. Papagaaidief in Afrikaans, says Gendry. I think he's just picked a piece of stick for a nest. A papagaaidief means a parrot dove. So that is a parrot dove in Afrikaans. One of our 11 official languages, aka Pidgin Dutch. Now, what else have we got? We've got a babbler up there, Gendry. I know how you love a babbler at a distance. And we seldom able to see them for any length of time. They normally run away from us. Well, they normally fly away from us. That is the arrow-marked babbler. So named because it has marks on its front that look like...
Spears.
Well done. That's exactly what they look like. Thank you, Jerry got it correct. Arrows, she said. Right, let's press on from the arrow-marked babbler. Of course, the arrow-marked babbler is a slightly hapless bird in that it spends much of its time raising the young of the Lavalliance cuckoo, completely oblivious to the fact that it's doing so. And by the time the Lavallian's cuckoo leaves the flock, the babblers are about that big, and the cuckoo is that big. And they are completely none the wiser. It looks totally different, has none of the same coloration, doesn't look remotely similar. And yet the poor, poor babblers think that they've just got a very oversized member of the colony in their flock. Now Byron has found something, the name of which is very specific and very close to my heart, and that is the Woodland and not Woodlands kingfisher. Oh, hang on. Jerry, you still with us? We're still here. Sorry, the camera's dying, everybody. It's struggling to focus. There's a tiny baby little tortoise. Let's go to Byron. We'll try and fix the camera. The camera's fixed. There we are.
Well, hopefully the tortoise doesn't move away quickly like this bird can. I'm so happy it stayed here. Yes, it is indeed a beautiful woodland kingfisher. And look at that coloration. And it's posing so nicely for us. Ah, this is great. Now, despite the name kingfisher, this little bird actually feeds on insects. There are other kingfisher species that do feed on fish, but this kingfisher feeds on insects, and that's why you find them out in the woodlands, in the thickets, and flying around looking for insects. Sometimes it will catch insects off the ground. But beautiful colors, really, really beautiful colors. And a beautiful call. They go tick-tr-r, tick-tr-r, something like that. There we go. Brian's pretty good at it. Speaking of the bird calls, Brian, James mentioned earlier that you were very good at doing the black-bellied bustard call. Would you like to give us a rendition of that?
I can.
Oh, that was very good.
Oh, not too bad.
Very, very good. Oh. I can't believe how calm this woodland kingfisher is. It's not decided to move at all. Oh, how beautiful birds. I mean, just look at that blue. And to think that these birds migrate all the way to North Africa during our winter, and then they return again in the summer, and we've been looking for them for a while. I'm not sure, some of our regular viewers might know how excited we get when we start hearing and seeing these woodland kingfishers, because for us out here in the bush, it's a sign that summer has arrived. These birds have got back for the summer, and it is wonderful to see them. Trying to see if I can find out for you quickly exactly where they migrate to. So Ethiopia, Somalia, Kenya, so east to North Africa, yeah, and then down, obviously, all the way down here where we are. And that's beautiful light on that bird now. Wow, I wish I had my camera with me. I actually left it at camp this morning, because that would be a beautiful photo of a woodland kingfisher. And surprisingly, now that I think about it, I don't have a photo of a woodland kingfisher. So I need to start taking my camera out and hopefully getting images like that. But sometimes it's also just nice to enjoy and appreciate the view or the sighting, even if you don't get a picture of it. Alright, we've Got about half an hour left of drive, a little bit longer than that. What I'm going to do, what I think I'm going to do, is firstly undo my jacket because it is incredibly warm right now. And then let's head back towards those lions and just see if they've moved, if they're still in that area. I think that's a good idea. Can see the cloud cover, still a bit of cloud cover around, but not as ominous is the word we used this morning, not as ominous as earlier this morning. But nice to see these clouds. I don't think we're going to get any rain. Perhaps if it builds up a little bit more, maybe later. All right, Brian, hold on tight. I'm gonna do this quickly. Oh, dangerous, living life on the edge. Look at that, multitasking at its best. Ta-da! Harry Houdini's got nothing on me. Oh, a little bumpy here. What was I going to say? I was going to say something profound, I'm sure. Yeah, I can't remember what I was going to say. Anyway, but James has found something interesting, something we don't see very often. Let's head across and see what it is.
There are some baboons, and I think the same troop that I heard calling a little bit earlier. I suspect they're heading towards quarantine. In fact, they're definitely heading that way. Now, baboons are actually eaters of meat when they can get it. And if they find that little impala lamb specifically, if they find that little piece of impala veal hanging in that tree, I suspect they will try and steal it. A little bit of bipedalism there. That means standing on 2 feet, Chandra. And I'm just hoping that this baboon troop will spend a bit more time here so it will relax around us. Because they are such fun to watch. But they're heading into some pretty thick stuff now, I'm afraid. Anyway. There they go. We'll just try and see if there aren't a few around the corner here. It's starting to warm up nicely now. You got one? See. There we go. He's eating the delicious Flugia verosa whiteberry bush, and they really are nice. Now, if that doesn't remind you of a human being, I don't know what would. This is amazing. It's so reminiscent for me, especially those ears. Until they walk, of course, then they look like baboons again. But when they're just sitting like that, it looks like sort of, looks a bit like Byron with a thick jersey on. And I'll try and find some more Flugia verosa or whiteberry bushes as we go, because they make a lovely snack. That's why this one of the reasons this time of year is so nice, is that there are fruits and things to eat, and the marula is not too long from coming. Probably only about, maybe a month. if that. And just listen to the birds of the heat of the day starting up the the southern black tit going bzz, 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 bzz. And also the chin spot battis. And I think that's probably a young male that's just got himself slightly isolated from the rest of the troop and feeling a little unsafe. Right, on we go. While we go on, Jamie Patterson is trying to get out of Charlotte's web.
And Charlotte has definitely outdone herself with this particular web. It is, in fact, many Charlottes in this particular case, and it is because it belongs to the spider known as the community nest spider. But the nice thing about this is that the community nest spiders are actually out in the open for once. And just see if you can have a look and see the exact spiders that are responsible for this web. Now, a little bit earlier on, we were with a colony of termites busy with their road building. Now, this is a very interesting situation because spiders are not really built to be communal nesters, except for these community nest spiders. And they're all, don't want to get in your way, they're all clumped around something. I actually think they're feeding on something in this clump that's in here. It's very difficult to see. And there is another clump. Ooh, sticky, sticky. There's another clump in there. This is an absolutely massive community nest. And when we first walked past it, I think Eggsy summed it up very well by saying you could catch an elephant in this particular nest. And he's not wrong. Well, he is wrong. But he's not... it was overly exaggerated. But... the point was very much very well made. So the spider's web, the highest attachment point is out of my reach at the top of the branch. It extends down in a sort of collection of sheets. So there's a sheet here, there's a sheet just behind it, a sheet, all of this incredibly sticky web. It then extends in sort of swaths across this side. Also, again, in sheets. And then there is a magnificent, massive nest. Net, not nest. The nest is there. There is a massive... I'm fine. There is an absolutely massive net, spider's net, over here. Now, I've been looking desperately to see where the Charlottes have left us any messages. I haven't found any, except perhaps stay out or you will get dead. That's a message. It doesn't need to be written. I think that's a relatively... Get off my finger. A relatively clear note to abandon hope, all ye enter here. All who enter here, all ye who enter here. Something like that. It made more sense in my head. But you get the idea. So they build these absolutely massive catchment webs. Oh, goodness, there's web everywhere. I'm scared I'm going to break something. You can see this massive anchor string. Interestingly enough, look what they've chosen as an anchor. It's an anchor point. I'm not quite sure how this occurred. I don't want to fiddle too much with it. But a stick attached to a dung beetle has been their choice of anchor. So incredible the way that they work. And of course something will fly... Oh goodness. Can't actually move here without getting yourself caught. Something will fly in, get stuck. Probably not an elephant, but probably something a little bit smaller. And will come in, get stuck. And then what the community nest spiders do is they send out raiding parties. Very brave, Eggsy. Very brave. I'm going to have to come and rescue you. They'll send out hunting parties to go and collect. And I did see one earlier, but I have lost it, unfortunately, that looked as though it was on its way to go and fetch some food for everybody. And it's kind of like the guy who goes out and gets the pizza at the door and brings it back for the rest of the party. That's basically what they do. And then I somehow imagine everybody cheers, all the Charlottes cheer. Charlottes, and they must have males in there as well. And what's the male version of Charlotte? Charlie. The Charlottes and the Charlies. I know that you're all a little bit freaked out by this whole... Oh, there's one coming out nicely. Just here. Oh, don't go away. Oh, no, the ant scared him away. Why are you scared of an ant, you stupid thing? You're 10 times bigger than it. You see him there, Eggs. Turned around and is running away like a big wuss. Apparently many of you are freaked out by the spiders. I understand that. My brother is terrified of spiders. He's not entirely comfortable in their presence. Personally, I find them fascinating. I've never been particularly nervous of them. But I do understand that something like this and something this massive might freak you out a little bit. And sometimes, if you pluck the web just right, you can actually get them... I've never managed to do it, but you can actually get them to come swarming out, which they don't appear to want to do. Last thing I wanted to show you, and I don't know that Eggsy with his antenna can actually get in here. Actually, oh, hello. Hello, James. He's chattering away. One thing I wanted to show you was not James Hendry, nor in fact was it Aubrey looking magnificent on the termite mound. Hi, James. Very well, and self.
You won't be able to hear me, of course, on the microphone, but Karuda, I suspect, is somewhere around here with the younger or the smaller cub. The older one is over there, and the younger one's tracks, I think, are over there. So it's quite possible that she has a kill and her other baby not too far from where you are currently standing.
Copy that. Thank you.
Excellent. We are going to continue on our way.
How wonderful. I'm sure you're all very keen to be back on the vehicle with such an entertaining gentleman. So off you go then. Onto the back of James's vehicle with you.
Now careful. Careful as you climb on. Careful now. There we are. Right, let's go. Goodbye, pajamas. Bye, Egbert. I think Karula's somewhere around there. I think she should carry on walking straight through there. I think she'll find her with Shongalai. Do you like the name Shongalai, Jandri? Shongalolo, yes. Shongalolo is an excellent name for leopard. We must, of course, be looking in the treetops here all along because she could have her second kill somewhere around here. There's a duiker, which I'm not going to try and show you because it'll run away immediately. Lots of birds, but none of them will sit still there. Jandre, look at the beautiful picture of a hornbill that I've got for you. Would you zoom in before it flies off to southern Antarctica? There we go. Isn't that gorgeous? Oh, that's really quite stunning. Now, of course, all the hornbills are in the midst of mating and breeding. Hello, Jamie. You're a new viewer, and you were wondering about my favourite bird to observe. Well, my favourite bird outright, of course, the white-browed scrub robin out here. But to watch, what birds do I like watching the best out here? I very much enjoy watching hornbills. I find their antics most amusing. They just are very character-filled. And this, of course, one of four hornbill species that we get here. Looking for, ooh, what's he got? A grasshopper. Right, we're going to pop past Treehouse Dam, see if there's anything there. Then we'll head for one last foray past Hosanna and on to quarantine. But in the meantime, Byron Sarau, he of the south of Johannesburg, a dubious part of the world, has found the lions again.
I have indeed found the lions, James, he who hails from... probably 10 kilometers north of me. so I don't know exactly how what that makes. Anyway, but these lions have moved slightly, everyone, just as I thought. They just moved into the shade a little further, but that's about it. Looks like most of the pride have all, they've just moved closer together, and they're lying in the shade of some gwarri trees, and there's some little knobthorns, young knobthorns, and some combretums. That's the trees that they are resting under, that providing shade for them. It has been a lovely morning though. It's funny, as soon as the sun disappears behind the clouds, then it warms up again. It cools down again, and then when the sun comes out, obviously it gets quite hot. But it's amazing how the temperature drops just as soon as the sun disappears behind the clouds. I've sustained an injury, I believe, of sorts. Now out here, obviously we put our lives on the edge and at risk every day. That's not quite that bad, but we do come across little insects that can sometimes cause quite a bit of irritation, and I think one has sat on me, and I've got, I don't know if you can see it over there, it's quite red around that area. Does it look red, Brian?
Yeah.
It is incredibly, it's perhaps a caterpillar, but it's incredibly itchy, and it happened yesterday getting back from the bushwalk. So I've possibly brushed against something while on walk, but these hairy caterpillars, you've got to be so careful of them, because they do cause massive itchiness and huge irritation to your skin, and I think that's possibly what got hold of me. Hopefully I'll survive. Hopefully. It's just nice to sit and listen, and I know some of you can hear some of the birds calling. I'm trying to see, there was sound like a white-browed scrub robin nearby. There's one calling further away. Oh, speaking of birds, Brian, there's a bird flying above us. Let's see if we can get it, maybe. So this is a vulture, I think. It is indeed, it is a hooded vulture. That's what that is, hooded vulture. See, things happen while you are just sitting around watching lions. Dale, you wanted to know about the lioness that we think was the one mating with the male the other day, or again, I say, think we didn't see them actually mating. So the one who was with one of the Birmingham males, with the coalition member, and she has returned to the pride. Now, perhaps you were not with us earlier. She has returned to the pride, so all five lionesses are with the Unkahuma pride at the moment, and we also have all six cubs here. So the whole pride is together, and I saw her tracks earlier. We were about 2 or 3 miles down, or basically directly east of here, and I could see where her tracks came from. She headed into this area to join up with the rest of the pride. Rebecca, you wanted to know if lions perhaps have a history, or perhaps contract something that causes them to have infertility and not have the ability to have cubs. You say, like the lioness that I've heard some people referring to as Amber Eyes. I'm not sure. I do think it is possible that sometimes, and I've seen it with leopards too, occasionally they'll mate and just not fall pregnant, because who knows. number of reasons, but perhaps infertility is one, and can happen. However, and maybe some of you viewers can help us, or help me rather. And does anyone know exactly how old that young lioness is, that amber eyes, that we think was the one mating with? Okay, so apparently she's around 6 years old now, so she should be ready to mate, definitely at that age. I'm just trying to think, and as I said, I haven't seen the males mating properly with her since I've been here. We've seen her with the males a few times, but I have not seen them spend 4 or 5 days mating with a female every day. It hasn't happened, or from what I've seen. So that plays a big role. Unless they mate regularly and efficiently, they're not going to fall pregnant. So I think, even the 2 days ago and yesterday, we saw with that male, we didn't see them actually mating. And who knows if they did. But the fact that she's back with the pride just makes me think that she possibly didn't. So all of those factors need to be taken into consideration. And but maybe we're lucky, and in the next few months, who knows, we could see some cubs from that female. Trying to show another vehicle how to get in here where we are, so they can also have a view of the lions. It is always nice, and I say it, but I do mean it. It's always nice to see people out on safari and out on vehicles enjoying the game viewing. Yeah, those. I just heard those wooden kingfishers. Do you hear that call? Listen. Those are woodland kingfishers. They're not too far, but I can't really see them. Let's just see if they call again. Oh, they've stopped. There, listen. Did you hear that sound? That was just another sound that the woodland kingfisher makes. Like high-pitched chattering almost that they do, and that's usually when a male and female might be in the same area. Morning, everyone. Morning. How are you? Good, thank yourself. So it looks like, just as I thought, I think these lions are going to potentially rest in this area for the day. But to be honest, it's always difficult to try and predict where they're going to move and where they're going to stay. With this cloud cover, the weather is a bit cooler, so there's a possibility they may decide to move at some point. And again, a lot of factors need to be taken into consideration. Are they full? Have they eaten recently? And from what we saw earlier, their bellies did look fairly full. Then they won't necessarily have to move. They won't necessarily have to go and look for food or hunt. But who knows? I've got a feeling, and I think they're going to stay in this area for the course of the day and maybe move later this afternoon or early evening. But we'll see, and we'll definitely see. We'll see on our sunset safari. I'm going to sit here a little bit longer, just till the end of the show, to see if they do move or not. In the meantime, let's head back to James and get an update from he who hails a few kilometers north of where I'm from.
It is not the number of the kilometers, it is the quality of them that is the count. Let me explain while I feel a little bit like I'm in a a loop here, because we have been looping around trying to see if we can find the other leopards. Byron lives in the south of Johannesburg, and yes, I do only live 10 kilometers. Well, I did only live 10 kilometers to the north of where he did. But between, you know, him and me was a chasm, a world of difference. And of course, many of the criminal underworld of Johannesburg come from the south of Johannesburg. I'm not saying Byron is the what? The Wemapan serial killer, for example. Exactly. Thank you, Jandre. The Wemapan serial killer comes from the south of Johannesburg. And who wants to come from the place that the Wemapan serial killer comes from? Exactly. There we are. Thank you. Now I'm sure you're all completely sorted and understand exactly what I mean. Byron is not the Wemapan. Was not the Wemapan serial killer. Right. I obviously have nothing further to contribute to anything right now, so let's head back to Jamie, who will always have something to contribute. She has got a poop-eating coleoptrid.
Also known as a dung beetle. We might not be able, Eggsy and myself are not going to be contributing to the mad argument that currently was playing out between Byron and James, but we are going to keep you entertained with the actions of this dung ball rolling dung beetle as he goes about gathering piles and what would you call it? It's not quite a handful that he's gathering, a leg full and... what would I call it? As he gathers loads of dung, in this case it was zebra dung, but it has been, it's completely lost its shape, which is relatively common in summer. It's almost, sometimes it's actually quite difficult to see what particular animal deposited the pile of dung that you're looking at. And he's working furiously. He hasn't managed to attract a lady friend just yet, although, is there hope on the horizon? Could this be the lady friend he's been looking for? Could he perhaps have the dung ball that will steal her heart? Or is it a male coming to steal his dung ball? The drama of the lives of dung beetles is always quite thoroughly entertaining. This way. This way. Aw. I'm sorry, buddy. Not today. Bye then. Off it goes. If it was a female, I guess she decided that he just didn't have the dung, or perhaps she just didn't see him, and it's one of those little tragedies of fate that they might have been destined to be together, but something just went a little bit wrong and she's gone off in the wrong direction. How tragic for him, he's put all this effort in. As he furiously pummels the dung ball, to create a nice, round, very solid structure that will be the ultimate end game. I nearly said end ball, but that's not what I mean. End game of this particular project. Oh, unfortunately, it seems as though our signal, or not our signal, but we're having minor problems with our feed, so we do apologize for that. I hope that you can still hear me apologizing. Sorry. So we're going to be saying goodbye to you. It is actually near the end of our sunrise safari stroll. So from myself, big thank you to Eggsy for his wonderful camera work, and to Aubrey for keeping an eye upon us, making sure that we're nice and safe. And most importantly, a thank you to all of you. I'm going to send you back across to the vehicles for now, and I'll see you on the sunset safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
We've come back to quarantine for, I think, the 65th time today. What have you got? A vervet monkey in the background. And we were hoping not to see the vervet monkey, although we are happy to see the vervet monkey, we were hoping to see the baboons coming out, perhaps, and making their way towards that carcass sitting in the tree. Anyway, time will tell over the course of the day what happens. It's nice and cool today, or it is for now, so we'll see what happens during the course of the day, whether the leopard returns, whether the baboons come there, but I think there will be some animal movement during the day because of the temperature. Did you hear that, Jandri? It's the impala talking to each other. Hopefully not the mother of the one in the tree. She's definitely calling her youngster, though, whoever that is. Right, well, as I've always said, you often think that you've heard it all and that there could be nothing that would surprise you ever again, and so often you're wrong when you think that, and I have now been astounded by a Twitter handle, the following. Everybody get ready, take this down. Tormented Zombie Owl. Tormented Zombie Owl would like to know if impala can get rabies. Tormented Zombie Owl, do you mind if I call you TZO? I just think it would be easier. TZO, all mammals apparently can get rabies, but it does affect them very differently. And so for the predators, often they get quite aggressive. You know, they foam at the mouth, they get aggressive. For human beings, they become hydrophobic. They get terrified of water. Then they get horribly thirsty, and then they shake about and die. Totally incurable in human beings once you start showing symptoms. Then in antelope, I think what it does is create completely the opposite effect. It creates malaise. This makes them very tired, and eventually they just kind of lie down and die. But yes, apparently all mammals can be affected by rabies. Some can carry. Many of the mongoose species out here do carry rabies. So if you're ever bitten by a mongoose, it's the first thing that you go and do is get post-exposure treatment regardless, but it doesn't affect them. There are some dogs I think it doesn't affect, but most it would affect. And then bats, of course, carry rabies as well. Some, not all bats. Now, I just want to look through here with my binoculars and to see if we can't catch those vervet monkeys again. You can't see them, can you, Jean-Dri?
The mother and baby.
Shall we move forward a bit into the clearing? It might give a slightly better view. All right, we're going to say goodbye to you here. I'm going to have one last turn past the tree, but not with you, because I don't think there's any real point. You've seen the dead impala, you don't need to see it again. We will see you this afternoon at 4 o'clock, of course. That is the normal time. Thank you for coming on Drive with us. It's been wonderful to have you with us. But for the last few minutes, let's head back to the south, to the Wemapan killer's kin, Byron Sarau.
James, thank you, James. Thank you very much for that. You've got his imagination sometimes, I wonder. Anyway, I'll have a word with James when I get back to the camp. The southern part of Johannesburg is actually a beautiful area. I think James is just jealous that he's not from the south. He's still sitting with his lions. They haven't moved, just as I thought. They are going to probably stay in the shade here. Those lionesses seem very relaxed. And I actually caught... a glimpse of two of the lionesses just lying off to the side where we saw them earlier. It's a bit tricky. I don't think you'll be able to see them. They're just through the thicket. And Jordan and Pat, you wanted to know, how do the lions survive with these thick coats? Well, we need to remember that these animals adapt to their surroundings depending on the temperature and the climate that occurs. So they have got ways of cooling down. The panting, lying in the shade, staying out of the sun during the heat of the day, all of that helps cool them down, or helps him stay cool. Yes, I'm sure they do get hot, just like we get hot, but they've adapted to the surroundings and to the climate that we get in these areas. So the coat is vital for animals, not just lions, but the coat on all big cats, and the coat on some of the antelope species and that too. It is needed, especially in winter. So in summer, all it does is it changes their behavior slightly. They won't be as active in the heat of the day, try and conserve their energy, try to stay in the shade, All of that helps cool them down a little bit more. I can hear a pearl-spotted owl calling in the distance. I wonder if you might be able to hear it. It might be a little bit far. Let's listen. I think it's a bit far. It's going. Can you get it?
Yeah.
That's the pearl-spotted owl, the start of the pearl-spotted owl call. It's got a beautiful call, and it's one of my favorite little owls. There, can you hear him again? Well, we've had a wonderful, wonderful morning. Thank you very much to Jamie and Viam, who were on bushwalk this morning, I believe.
Eggsy
on bushwalk, and James and Viam, and myself and Brian and the Thumb. Thank you to the voices in my head, or the ladies in control, final control, Rebecca and Jerry. We'll see you all this afternoon. Goodbye and have a wonderful day.